si Aiman dan juga. Jadi
kembali lagi ulang lagi ya. Okay, soalan nombor 2 yang popular.
-3 -3 0 2. So kita dapat apa? -3 0 2.
Jadi akan jadi
jadi sama-sama kita tumpukan perhatian kepada teori kinetik ciri. Okey.
Kalau tak percaya dia kita pun ada ajaran yang seperti
ini. Kami kena ingat dia diberi gelaran penyelamat umat Islam. Ingat yang itu.
Perbandingan berkaitan perumpamaan yang panjang Maharaja Leda.
Dia ni kat tengah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh everyone and welcome to Mahir Teacher.
One of the main reasons why students cannot score in their English SPM is because they do not have the right answering techniques. Achieving A in English SPM is possible. All you need is the right technique and the right tutor. Hi everyone, I am Ms. Zee Jamil, Mahir Tutor English SPM teacher. I graduated from UITM Shah Alam in Tassel and I am also Janus International Emotional Intelligence Practitioner. I have been in education industry for the past 12 years and I started my teaching career in MRSM Langkawi back in 2008. And for the past 12 years, mashallah, we have developed a lot of different tips, different techniques which can help students from all walks of life to excel in English. So regardless whether you are a D student, C student or even B student, we are going to help you to score A for your English SPM. Whenever I tell people that, you know, I used to teach in MRSM Langkawi, people always say that, well, they are excellent students. Of course, you should be aiming to get like 100% A. But there was one particular year, if I'm not mistaken, back in 2010, like we were really scared because we aimed to get 100% A. But then again, there was one student who had like consistently been getting C, D, C, D. Even he got a C for his trial SPM. But mashallah, when the result was released, mashallah, he scored A minus. Well, he was the only one who scored A minus because the rest got A and A plus. But then again, hey, from C, D to A minus, isn't that amazing? So to all SPM candidates, join me, Teacher Z, in Mahir Tutor Online.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh everyone and selamat datang ke seminar SPM 2020 online dibawakan khas oleh Mahir Tutor. Dan apa khabar adik-adik hari ini? Semua orang okey? Alright. Okey, sebelum kita mulakan, pastikan adik-adik dalam keadaan selesa dan bersiap sedia dan pastikan ada buku nota dan pen. Okey. Untuk makluman semua, Mahir Tutor kini telah mencecah lebih 20,000 pelajar di seluruh Malaysia di mana adik-adik semua boleh mengakses bahan-bahan pengajaran. Kita ada 10 subjek SPM melalui website kami di planetmahir.com/tutor pada bila-bila masa dan di mana-mana juga adik-adik berada. Sama ada adik berada di Pahang, di Selangor, di Terengganu, adik-adik boleh akses je kepada bahan-bahan ini hanya dengan melalui website kami planetmahir.com/tutor. Dan adik-adik juga boleh mengikuti pengajaran setiap silibus sama ada tingkatan 4 ataupun tingkatan 5 sebab sebagai ulang kaji sebelum SPM bulan depan. Sebelum semua kelas pengajaran okey telah direkod dan boleh diakses secara video on demand. Okey, bagi adik-adik di luar sana yang masih belum mendaftar, bolehlah PM kami sama ada di Facebook Planet Mahir ataupun di Instagram Mahir Tutor. Baiklah, ada semua orang dah ready dah? Okey, so untuk sesi kali ini, kita akan ditunjuk ajar tentang tips, tricks, teknik-teknik macam mana nak skor dalam subjek bahasa Inggeris. Dan kita sangat bertuah hari ini kerana bersama kita adalah Puan Najimah Ahmad Bashir, guru kanan mata pelajaran bahasa Inggeris dari Sekolah Menengah Kebangsaan Lelaki Bukit Bintang. Adik-adik sangat beruntung hari ini kerana Cikgu Najimah, Puan Najimah telah mengajar selama 21 tahun dan beliau merupakan guru cemerlang tahun 2009-2014. Okey, adakah adik-adik dah bersedia? Okey, sekiranya adik-adik ada apa-apa soalan, adik-adik boleh bertanya dengan soalan di ruangan chat box dan insyaAllah kita akan pilih 3 soalan terbaik untuk dijawab oleh Puan Najimah. Silakan Puan Najimah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh and a very good morning everyone. I'm very happy to be here today to share with you some of the techniques and strategies on how to do well in paper one. Okay, paper one, which is an essay paper. And generally students, they are worried about paper one. Today, I will share with you some of the techniques and strategies that you can do, that you can use in order to do well in your paper one. Okay, I think by now we know paper one has two sections, section A and section B. Section A is directed writing. Okay, and section B would be continuous writing. So today, for the first part, I will discuss on section A before moving on to section B. Okay. As we know, this particular section A, there are a few types of article that you know by now, yeah? We have article, we have report, we have speech, we have talk, we have formal letter, and we also have informal letter. Okay, format is one of the aspects that you must remember that you can easily score in paper one, section A. Format gives you 3 marks, okay? And by now you would know the format of an article, of a talk speech, of an informal letter, formal letter, and report. One thing wonderful about section A is the question will help you, okay? Will tell you what are the things that you must have for format. I will show you later, okay? All right. For today's, for this particular directed writing question, I will be using the trial paper 2020 from the state of Perlis, okay? If you look at the question, you took part in an English language week program organized by an English language, by the English language department of your school. Write a letter to your cousin who lives in another town about the event, all right? So now you know you are going to write a letter. That and what type of letter would that be? Okay, later as we progress, you will see. Okay, now every part of the directed writing question is giving you some kind of guidance or help. All right, so here is the title, Section A, directed writing. So here the question paper is indirectly indicating you are going to answer directed writing. Here is the marks. That means for directed writing, you will be working or to get 35 marks. And how much time do you need to spend? You need to spend 45 minutes. That is the time suggested. Okay. And what I read to you just now would be the instruction. This is very important. Why is this important? Because the instruction is what going to guide you throughout. Okay. So from the beginning, you know, okay, you are going to write a letter. To who? To a cousin, all right? So you indirectly, you are setting the target. Okay, this is where I'm gonna go. Okay, I'm gonna write a letter. Okay, now this is what we call content points, okay? Here, every single bullet that you see is important. Why? Because every single bullet is a mark, okay? It gives you 1 mark. Okay, now this is where you need to pay attention as well. Why? Because here it is actually giving you some reminders. Okay, when you lay out the letter correctly, remember to make sure. So here you can see, I must have address, I must have salutation, I must have closing. So these three will be giving you the 3 marks. Remember I told you just now, format, how many marks? 3 marks. So if you don't remember, don't worry, because here will be the reminders to help you to make sure that when you write your essay, you have the marks, the correct layout for that particular format. Okay, here the reminder also says, develop all the points given. Provide your own ideas when needed. Remember that your letter is to your cousin. So here you can see every part of the question paper is actually some form of help for you. That is why please remember to answer. Okay, answer directed writing. Okay, please answer. Don't leave directed writing out. Okay. And here you can see the allocation of marks. For this letter, you will receive 15 marks for format. Okay, and 20 marks for language. Okay, so this is the breakdown. Format will be 12 marks, content will be 12 marks, and language will be 20 marks. So the total of 35 marks. Okay. Right. These are some of the SPM, past year SPM questions which you can refer to, and you will see what are some of the questions that has already been out. Okay. So article for SPM 2019, report 2 years in a row, 2017 and 2018. Speech talk was out for 2015 and 2016. All right. And letter, okay. SPM 2010, the question was on a formal letter. All right. Okay. And 2012, it was an informal letter. Okay. When you get the question paper, I've mentioned just now, and I'm repeating it again because it is very, very important and very, very crucial. Read the instructions carefully, okay? It clearly states the format to use. It gives you the purpose of the essay, okay? And it also guides you on how to start your essay. Now, if you feel that you are not very confident, if you feel you don't know how to start, don't worry, okay? Because you will see that actually the question itself, the instruction itself is giving you some help, some form of help to help you start. You took part in an English language week program organized by the English language department of your school. So if you don't know how to start, you just change you to I. I took part in an English language program organized by the English language department of my school. Write a letter to your cousin who lives in another town about the event. So I am writing this letter to share about the event with you. So here, if you are stuck, if you don't know how to start, the instruction will help you. Just change the pronoun and you will have an introduction. Okay? Okay. So one of the things that you must do when you get your question paper, make sure you label, all right? The content points. Okay, make sure you label the content points. Why? This is to help you remember not to miss any of the content points. Okay, so here I have labeled C1 all the way to C12. So I know in this question paper, 12 content points are given, but some are direct, some are indirect. Okay, I will show you in a minute. Okay, how do I know it's a content point? Because content point comes in 3 ways. Duration, venue, okay, in the question just now, all right, it comes in the form of a question. Sometimes it will be a phrase, very direct. You just take the phrase and put it into a sentence and you will have a content point. And sometimes the content point will come in the form of your own idea, all right? That means it's there, but you have to think of a suitable point to be included in that particular that particular content point. Okay, here is an example for duration, which gives you the content mark of 1. Okay, that is C1. Yeah, so Decide on the duration that is suitable for an English language week and use the answer to write out the content point. So English language week was organized for 5 days. So here I will get my mark for C1 because why? I've mentioned that the duration for this particular English language week is for 5 days. Okay. Now, objective one, encourage the use of English. So I make a sentence. Okay. One of the objectives of the English language week is to encourage the use of English. So here I will get my C3. Okay. For objective two, I had to come up with my own idea. Okay. But it must be relevant to the situation given. So my idea would be, the program also helps us to motivate each other to speak in English language. So I will get my C4. Why? Because it is relevant to the question. Okay. Now, this is a very common question. Yeah. Can I combine my content points? Yes, you can. All right. Yes, you can. You can combine your content points. Here, for activities, we have C6, C7, C8. So here, what I have done is I decided to combine my content points. Okay. There were many interesting activities such as spelling bee, public speaking, and singing competition. So I get my C6, C7, C8. Okay. Right. But I would like to advise you not to do this for all the content points. You cannot do this for all. Why? Because if you do this for all the content points, then the examiner would not be able to see how good you are with your language. So don't do this for too many content points. Maybe one or two is accepted. Okay. All right. This is another common question. Can I change the order of my content points? The answer would be yes, you can. All right, you can. For example, I want to start my essay by giving the objectives of the English language week first. Okay, although the question starts out with duration, but I want to start with objective first. And then I want to bring in the activities before I go to the duration and venue. Yes, you can. It is okay. But remember, when you do this, you are moving the content points around. And when you move the content points around, make sure you tick what are the content points that you have used. Okay, and remember to look back and see, oh, these are the content points that are waiting for me, okay, to be taken and to be used in the essay, okay? So my advice would be, if you think you are able to move your content points around, go ahead. But remember, you must make sure you don't leave any of the content points out, okay? Okay, what about elaboration and example? Okay, is it important to elaborate every content point? No. Is it a must for me to give example for every content point? No. But if you do this, okay, especially for those of you who are very good in the language, you can write very well, then I would encourage you to write and to elaborate and give example, because as I mentioned just now, this would help the examiner to see how well you are, how proficient you are with the language, and how well you can write. Okay. All right. Here, I'm giving one example, okay, instill confidence. So one of the benefits of participating in English language is it would help to instill confidence. Okay, here I will get my C9. Okay, so confidence gives us the energy to take action to achieve our personal goals and dreams. Okay, here what I've done is I've given elaboration. But for my own idea in C10, I've added one more element. Okay, here. The activities planned for the week made me realize that some of my friends are very talented. I get my C10. My best friend Adam is a very talented singer, especially in singing pop, rock, and rap genres. Okay. I have given my elaboration and I've added, okay, a few words as example to prove that my friend Adam is actually a very talented singer. So, for C9, I have elaboration. For C10, I have elaboration plus example. Okay, right. Okay, and the ticks will come up. All right. Now, for language, we are looking at 20 marks. Okay, so basically, this will be the grade and mark range. Okay, if you are very proficient with your language and you can write very well, then of course you will be aiming for 19 to 20, and it goes all the way down to the very weak ones. Okay, but my advice to you, directed writing, don't leave it out. Write, okay, write, because the help is there. Write as even if it's simple sentences, I will show you in a minute. Write, okay, don't leave it out. Okay, for directed writing, these are the aspects that you must focus on. Okay, accuracy, able to convey what you want to express clearly. It doesn't matter if it's a simple sentence, but make sure you construct your simple sentence clearly so that the examiner or even your teacher, when she reads or he reads, they will be able to understand what you're trying to say. All right, so that they don't have to think, what is this particular candidate or this, what is my student trying to tell me? Okay, so write it clearly, accurately, so that the examiner would be able to understand what you are saying. Okay, sentences. Now, generally, there are three types of sentences. Yeah, simple, compound, and complex sentences. If you are not very confident and you are comfortable with simple like such sentences, it's okay. It's okay to write simple sentences, okay? As long as you write. What we teachers are worried is students don't write. So write simple, compound, complex, it's okay. If you can write simple, good. If you can write compound, excellent. Complex will be the best. But as long as you write, write in whichever structure that you are comfortable with. Here, I give you an example. I want to be a chef. Simple. I want to be a chef, but my parents want me to be a teacher. Compound. Complex. Although I have decided to become a chef, but my parents keep insisting that I should become a teacher. All right? The meaning is the same, but it is worded differently. But at the end of the day, the reader is able to understand. Okay? That is what is important. Okay. Vocabulary. Okay. Vocabulary are words used to express. Now, some of us, we can use very good words to express what we are trying to say. Some of us, we don't have that many vocabulary, okay? It's okay. As long as you are able to tell us what you are trying to tell us, then you are fine. If you are able to use good words to further show that you are very good with the language, then go ahead. But one thing I want to advise you, vocabulary, Make sure you use the right vocabulary. Yeah? Sometimes some candidates, they remember very good words, but they use it at the wrong places. So don't do that, okay? You make sure when you use a word, you understand what the word means. And you must ask yourself, would this word fit in with what I'm trying to say, okay? Now, next is organization. Organization is also very important. Remember just now I showed you C1 to C12, okay? So you must organize your directed writing in such a way that it is very easy for the examiner to understand, all right? When you organize it in a way where you don't have a proper introduction, okay, suddenly you have the content point. Then towards the end, there's no conclusion. That means you did not organize your essay well. Okay, and that is also going to be taken. That is also going to be one of the aspects that the examiner would look into. All right, okay. Punctuation. This looks like a very simple and basic, okay, but it plays a very major role in essay. When you don't put a full stop, that means that then you will have 2-3 sentences coming together, all right? And then the examiner would have, or even your teacher, okay, would have problem trying to understand, because there's no full stop. You need to understand, comma is important, full stop is important. If you are giving a dialogue, okay, open inverted and close inverted are important. Capital letters are important. All these punctuations are very important, okay, when you write essays. Spelling. Okay, next aspect is spelling. Yes, if you want to make sure you don't simply give away marks, make sure you spell the words correctly. Okay, and the last one would be style and tone. If you are writing to a principal, it must be polite, it must be respectful. If you are writing to a friend, then it can be casual. don't mix, okay? Don't try to be too, don't try to sound casual when you're actually writing a letter to a principal or you are complaining to an authority. You cannot be casual, okay? The style and tone is very important, okay? Right. So here are some of the recommendations for you. This is for Section A, okay? And it is to read the instructions carefully, okay? Make sure about the, be sure of the format and the task. Underline the keywords. If you have a highlighter, you highlight. If you have a pencil, it's okay. If you have a pen, colored pen, underline the keywords. Important, because when you are, whenever you feel you are not sure, you can straight away go back to the highlighted or the word that you underline. Okay. Next, use the all the content points. I've mentioned that just now. Use the appropriate tone. I've discussed with you just now. Use various structures. Okay, I've showed you simple, compound, complex sentences. But if you are able, as I said just now, don't be stressed out. Don't feel afraid to write just because you cannot write compound sentences. No, if you can write simple sentences, just write simple sentences. Yeah. Okay. Next, improve your spelling. This is very important, especially simple, basic words. Try to avoid making errors, okay, mistakes on simple spelling, okay, and do not take punctuation lightly. Yes, all right. And between now and next month, take some time to read so that you can improve. Even if you read maybe only a few pages a day, I'm sure, okay, when you are preparing for your SPM later, it will help in a way or the other, okay. Right. Now we move on to Section B. Section A is 45 minutes. Section B is 1 hour. So this paper is 1 hour and 45 minutes. Okay. Now, for this paper, this section is very, very crucial, very important. Why? Because it gives you the most marks. Here you have 50 marks. Okay. Just now it was only 35 marks, but here you have 50. So it's a very big, a very huge chunk of mark is here. All right. Now, when you talk about this particular section, there are 5 types of essay that you will be that will come around. Okay, descriptive essay. One thing I want to remind you about descriptive essay is, when you write, you have to describe. Describe means you have to use a lot of adjectives. Okay, you have to show even if I'm not there, but when I read that essay, I should be able to get a very clear picture what happened, okay, how did it happen, okay, who were involved, how bad was the situation. So as I read, I should be able to get a very clear picture. You see, the key word here is provide reader with enough detailed description, able to picture or imagine. All right, so description. Descriptive essay means you have to describe. You have to use a lot of words to make the situation or the scenario clear. Okay. For SPM 2019, you have 2 questions, okay, that has elements of descriptive in it, okay? If you had a chance to be someone else, who would you choose to be? Explain what would be good about being that person and what might be difficult. So, what good would it be about being that person? So you are going to describe that person to us, okay? Who is that person? What is so wonderful about that person? Okay, question 5. Write about the day you first met your best friend. Describe where you were, how you began talking to each other. Explain how your friendship has developed. So all these are description. Now you are describing to us, okay? Next, argumentative or opinion. Argumentative and opinion questions are very popular among candidates who like to read a lot, because sometimes some of the questions are very factual. You need to give facts. So if you don't have that much, that, you know, you don't read much and therefore you are not very sure about some of the content that you want to add to your essay, then maybe this may not be so suitable for you, yeah? Okay. Question two, okay, this is again SPM 2019. Modern inventions have made our lives much too complicated. Things used to be a lot simpler in the past. How far do you agree? Explain why. So you have to be very clear what modern inventions are. And you have to be clear, you know the meaning of the word complicated. All right? Okay, what about question four? Which do you think is more important, money or health? Okay, this one is quite general. Okay, so maybe a lot of there would be candidates who would be interested to write this. But compare, you must compare the two. That means you must talk to about money. You must talk about health. Why is money important? Why is health important? And then later on, you must decide if one is more important than the other. All right? These are the things. If you notice what I'm doing, I'm highlighting, I'm actually underlining some of the keywords because that would help me to make sure I am on track. I'm writing what I'm supposed to write. I don't go somewhere else, okay? I must stick to my lane, okay? And make sure I reach my destination safely, okay? Now, expository requires the student to investigate an idea, evaluate evidence, okay? And then set forth. And you don't have to worry, yeah? You don't have to worry, teacher, I don't understand what is description. I don't understand what is argumentative. It's okay. This is just to tell you. You don't have to know all this. What is important is this, okay? If you had a chance to be someone else, who would you choose to be? Explain. Okay, so again, so just now, 2019, question one, it has some elements of descriptive. It also has some elements of expository. So it can have both, all right? Narrative. This is very popular among SPM candidates. Because why? It's actually writing a story. Okay, so here you have two questions. 2019, they had two questions. Question three and question five. Question five is your best friend. And question three, write a story about two people who had an argument because one of them had lost a mobile phone. Okay, I would like to attract your attention to this. End the story. Now, if the question says end the story, this must be your last line. You cannot have anything else after that. If the story says begin your story, then whatever the phrase or the line given would be the first line of your essay. Please take note of the word end or begin. It is very important, especially if you decide to write story. Okay. Reflection. Okay, this one is a reflection. It will give you a question that needs you to look back at something that happened and then what you have learned from it. Okay, or what how has it changed you? Okay. Okay. Now, so for section B, these are some of the aspects. There's a lot actually, but these are the main things that you must remember. Tenses. If you are writing a story, then automatically the tense, most parts of the essay would be maybe, most probably it will be past tense because you are actually writing a story. But there are parts of the essay that would be, if it's a dialogue, maybe it will be in present tense, okay? So tenses, they are very important, okay? Subject-verb agreement. Is, are, was, were, okay? Don't make mistakes on that if possible, yes? Because subject-verb agreement is also very crucial. And word choice. As I said just now, vocabulary is very important. If you choose the wrong word to be put in that sentence, then the meaning might be very different from what you were actually trying to tell someone. Here I have a sample, Kupasan Mutu Jawapan SPM 2017. Yeah, it is actually online. You can have a look at it. Okay, question three. Okay, the Malaysian tradition of having open house is important and should be practiced more. Do you agree? Give reasons to support your view. So here you have this particular candidate, as I said, is from Kupasan Mutu Jawapan SPM 2017. Vocabulary and phrases, yeah? So if you look at this candidate used the word foreign visitors. So this candidate has very specifically informed the reader that I am looking at foreign visitors. Okay, visitors, but here I'm looking at foreign visitors. And this candidate used the word apex of holiday. rich in hidden treasure, notable historical landmarks, not any landmarks, notable historical landmarks. Keep up with to our image as highly educated and civilized people. Okay, not just people, but as very highly educated and civilized people. So here, you are being very clear. The candidate is very being very clear, okay, using very precise vocab and phrases to show what the candidate is trying to tell us. Okay, sentence structure. Okay, as I told you just now, simple, compound, complex, okay, the basic three. And then here you have a candidate who is able to use complex sentences, okay? To be frank, open house is an event in which, okay, the host prepares a feast and invites all members of the general public to attend. So, okay, it's a complex sentence and it makes the essay, for this candidate, maybe the candidate is a very fluent, okay, can write very well. So he or she was able to use complex sentences. Okay, punctuation. As I said, question mark, comma, full stop, they are very important. Okay, spelling. Okay, spelling is also very important for section B, just like section A. Definitely, it's a very common mistake. These are some of the common mistakes, all right, that candidates tend to make. Okay, besides tradition, the correct, okay, look at the spelling. Tradition. Okay, so these are some of the spelling errors that you must try to avoid. Okay, subject matter. Subject matter means if the question is asking you to talk about, let's say the question is asking you to talk about pollution. So throughout the essay, you must make sure that you stick to that subject matter. The subject is on pollution. So make sure you stick to that. All right, you can go off tangent a little bit, but you must make sure you come back. But usually during SPM, you are very stressed. Okay, and one of the mistakes I think candidates make is they don't plan. They don't plan, they look at the question, they straight away start writing. Please try to plan. If you don't plan, you get stuck, you will start again. You might not have time to complete the essay as well as you wanted to. So plan. Section B is all about planning. Section A, it is given. The plan is already there. You just follow. But section B is you planning. If you don't plan, what am I going to write in my intro? What am I going to write in my first paragraph? What am I going to write in my second paragraph? If you don't have that flow, then there is a high possibility you will get stuck. Okay, when you get stuck, generally students would do is go back to the question paper. Look at the question paper again. Maybe not this question. I want to do this. Start again. Okay, all that is not going to be helpful. So please try to avoid all that mistakes. Okay, so generally I've come to an end of my section A. But if you have any question, I will be more than ready to answer. So Teacher Z.
Thank you so much, Teacher Najima, and I believe that all of you out there, we have gained a lot of new information. It's good to refresh, you know. I believe that teachers at school, they have been doing a wonderful job, Teacher Najima. But yes, with the additional input from Teacher Najima, of course, this can help you a lot more for you to score your English paper, inshallah. All right, Teacher Najima, if you can share with our students, currently we have about 119 students watching our live today. So is it true that when the teachers, the examiners mark the papers, there are like two types of mistakes, you know, like major mistakes and minor mistakes, you know, especially when it comes to grammar. So can you explain further?
Okay, mistakes, yeah? Okay, now, actually, when we look at SPM, I think it's your teachers are also marking it the same way as the examiners are. Mm-mm. What happens is we will read the text, okay, the particular script, and let's say if this is a very good sentence, then we will give a tick. Mm-mm. Okay? If there are errors, okay, let's say this particular candidate, this is an error, so we will underline. If there is a very small error, then we will make a wiggly line. So the when we give our marks, the total marks, of course, we will be looking at all these errors. Okay, these errors. This is not an error, by the way. I'm just doing it. I mean, just for an example. If there are a lot of these errors, then if you see error, then of course the examiner will be saying, okay, this is a lot of error. So for an A script, what are the criteria? Okay, you must understand. You don't have to be today. All the SPM candidates out there, please don't worry that examiners they mark when they are tired. Mark is going to be different. It doesn't go that way. No. There is a very clear how should I put it? There is a marking scheme. There, okay, for A script, the candidate must have A, B, C, D, E, F. Okay. If this candidate has all the A, B, C, D, E, F, A. Okay, so don't worry about the examiners no marking and then they will just mark without actually paying attention to your good word, the words that are used well and all that. No, it doesn't go that way. All right, so don't worry. The examiners, I'm sure they will try their best to read your script more than once, and they will try their best to give you the best band that you will be in. Okay.
All right. Thank you so much, Teacher Najimah. There, we have one question from Nur Shafika. Do you have any tips to do narrative essay? Because my teacher told me to try remember one narrative essay. What is your opinion about on this tip, Teacher Najimah?
Okay.
Narrative essay.
First, I would ask the candidate if the candidate is confident answering narrative essays. Okay? Because just remembering one essay, if you ask me personally, because we don't know what the question would be.
Okay? Exactly.
Memorizing an essay, and then you find that the essay does not fit in to the narrative essay that you have memorized, then it is back to square one. You still have to decide what you are more confident in answering. So if you ask me personally, I would say, go through the past year question papers, look at every year. Okay, for me, what I would suggest my boys here, what I will tell them is, go through the SPM papers, look at the section, the continuous paper, look at the type of questions. Okay, which are the type of questions that you are very confident? No matter what, how they word it, you are still confident in answering it. So if you feel that you are more confident with story, let's say, because I think generally candidates are very confident with story, not all, but generally. So if you're confident with story, then I suggest you read more stories out there. All right, more maybe you go online, look for good stories, you read, so that no matter what the question comes up, you can use some of the ideas from the stories that you have read, and then you can actually come up with your own piece of essay. Memorizing essays, if you ask me, with the current SPM questions, may not be that suitable lah. Okay, it is an option, but it may not be so suitable if the question does not go relate to what you have memorized. That would be my response.
Thank you, Teacher Najimah. I hope, Nur Shafika, you are clear with the explanation given by Teacher Najimah. Thank you. And we have another question from Amelia Nazira. They have a lot of questions on narrative essay, Teacher Najimah. So Amelia said, I usually do narrative essays. Do you have any tips on what type of narrative you think is the best? Like emotional or happy? Thank you.
Okay. Now, it depends on the question. Okay. If the question wants you to write a narrative essay, because you see, everything is based on the question. If I tell you happy would be the best way, but the question may not, the question needs some element of sadness in it. Okay? So it all depends on the question. But one thing I can tell you is when you write narrative essays, try not to, this is general. Usually the narrative essay, the ending would be a sad ending, okay, where I know candidates are trying to touch the emotion of the examiner, but don't overdo it, okay, to the extent that it doesn't flow with the story. You must flow with the story. Whatever you write must flow with the story, okay, that you are trying to tell us lah. All right, like this one, both of them realized how foolish they had been. So here the situation is, had an argument. So of course, I'm sure at the beginning something must have happened, and therefore causing one of them to lose their handphones. Okay, so some they might have argued in a very harsh way, in something must have happened, but at the end they've realized, okay, that they both were foolish in what they have been doing throughout that story. So the ending is this. So that's why I say it all depends on the question. If the question ending is as such, then you can plan your story, you can work out your story in such a way that the ending would be what they want it to be. If the story, the beginning is already given, then you tailor-make your story so that it fits in to the beginning of what is given. Okay. I think that is what I can say at the moment nah, for this particular question.
All right. Thank you, Teacher Najima. All right. I hope you're happy with the explanation, Amelia. All right. We have another question from Nabil. How to write the best intro of a narrative essay? I think that's a common question. How do we start? If the first few words are not given.
If the few first few words are not given. Okay. Of course, it depends on the question. All right. Okay. Let's look at this question. Okay. Write a story about two people who had an argument because one of them had lost a mobile phone. So if you ask me, I might start with something like, okay, Nabil, did you see my handphone? Where is my handphone, Nabil? Did you take it? So I start with a dialogue. Okay. So a dialogue can be a good way of starting the essay, because dialogue usually captures a reader's attention very quickly. Or you can say, there was a sudden knock on the door. Nabil rushed to the door and he opened the door. Sulaiman was standing in front of him. Nabil, did you see my handphone anywhere? So here I start differently. I start with a sentence, okay? Trying to attract the reader's attention indirectly there was a knock on the door. So for me as a reader, I will straight away say, oh, there was a knock. What's going to happen next? So a good intro would be an intro that captures the reader's attention and want to read more. That particular reader wants to read more to find out what the story is all about. Okay? So two examples from me at the moment. Any more question?
All right. We have Nuhan Nabila. Nuhan, I'm not sure whether a male or female student. Okay, the students asked about contraction. Can they use do not? Can they use don't instead of do not in their essay? I mean, both directed and continuous.
Okay, for direct, okay. Now, you use contractions in dialogues is okay. Okay, for dialogues, okay. But if it's if it's a directed writing, especially if it's going to be very formal and polite, then avoid using contractions. Okay, you try to write out don't and do not. So just write do not. Okay, if it's a dialogue, then okay. Avoid using contractions when it's not a dialogue. Write full. Okay, don't try to shorten it. Okay, right. Next.
All right, thank you. Okay, it's Nama Saya. This name is Nama Saya. Is it true that we must end the narrative essay with moral values? Is it a must?
It's not a must, okay? But because you see, like question three, it's the ending is already given. Okay, so if you want to add the moral value, it must be before the ending. Okay, both these boys, they sat and read and talked to each other, and looking back at all their fond memories, and they realized how. So there are questions where you can add in the moral values, but there are questions the moral value can be seen in the story. Okay, we will be able to see there are some elements of moral values there. Moral values does not need it. You don't have to put it. You don't have to write it out explicitly. Like the moral value of this story is, it doesn't have to be that way. As we read, we will be able to see that there are elements of moral values coming in through, as we progress in the story. Okay, all right. All right, next question.
Okay, the next question is from me, Teacher Najima. Oh, yes. We know that for narrative, continuous writing, they have to reach at least 350 words. And we do understand, we acknowledge that some students, they have challenges in English. And like looking at the number itself, how am I going to write like 350 words essay? So yes. For those who have challenges in English, what is the best tip that you can share for them to actually have a story or, give a good answer, write a good answer for continuous writing?
Okay. This 350 words, is already mentioned in the question paper, all right? But, and I know, I understand, because I even have candidates, my students who struggle. Okay, what I would tell them is, no matter what happens, number one, don't leave the paper blank. Number two, read the question and choose the question that you are confident with. Number three, plan. Plan. You at first you feel you can write question number one very confidently, but suddenly as you plan, you feel no, I cannot. Then choose another one. The moment you decide. You plan, you decide, then, because I think even for weak students, they will try to choose a question that they are confident with. So one thing that if you don't know how to continue with after a sentence, start asking the WH question. Okay? What? Who? Who? What? Where? When? Why? How? Okay? So the moment you get stuck, Ali is a friend, is my best friend. Okay, I don't know how to continue. Okay, then you ask yourself, who, what, where, when, why? Which question can I answer next? So the moment you start asking the WH questions I use this method to help students write longer essays, because I tell them, the moment you are stuck, ask yourself a question. Okay, ask yourself a question. And that WH question will help you to write the next sentence. Okay? Of course, if you struggle, you are somebody who really struggle to write, you may not reach 350. But don't worry about the number of words. Don't worry about number of words. What we want is that we write. Because it's okay even if you get 15 over 50. That 15 marks is very valuable. Okay? That 20 marks is very valuable. Why? Because when you have section A, section B combined plus, then you get more marks. I don't want my students to leave it blank just because they don't know how to write 350 words. What is important is you write as well as you can. Don't compare with another friend who writes 350 words. If I can only write 200 words, I write for 200 words. What I get for 200 words is very valuable for me. Okay, so that is how I tell my boys lah. So I think that tip can also work for the candidates out there who are listening to us, who are very, very afraid of section B, all right, because they feel they cannot write. Don't worry, the moment you get stuck, WH question. Okay, who, what, where, when, what, when, who, what, where, when, why, how. The five, W1H. Five, okay, so 5W1H, you use this technique, start, ask one of this, then you write the next sentence. Okay, I hope this is helpful.
All right, thank you, Teacher Najima. And a final question from Nuhan again. Is it better to write the to write directed writing, to start with directed writing first or continuous writing first? Because they have 1 hour, 45 minutes, right? So yeah. Which one should they start first based on your experience?
Thank you very much. I think this is a very, very important question. My personal suggestion, and I also share this with my own students, please do section A first. Please do directed writing first. Why? Number one, everything is given. You don't have to think so much. It's there. Just take and write. Okay, so please do directed writing first. Second, let's say the directed writing is very easy. Okay, you are able to finish in 30 minutes. The question say 45 minutes, you finish in 30 minutes. You have 15 minutes extra for section B. So you have 1 hour and 15 minutes. That is very valuable. What happens with some of the candidates, the good ones, I would say, they want to finish off section B first because they feel then they can go to section A. Okay, what happens is, section B, sometimes there's a high possibility you get carried away. You will write and write and write, and then you want to add on this climax, you want to add on this particular moment of, you want to create some wow moment in the story. You begin to work with it you are really focused that you forget you have another section waiting. Okay, so my suggestion to you would be, write section A, get it done, put it aside. The time that is left, if you have 10 minutes extra here, bring that. That means you have more time to plan. You can spend that extra 10 minutes from section A. You use that time to plan. Okay, then 1 hour you can write. One of the mistakes that candidate makes sometimes is the examiner might say, okay, masa tinggal 5 minit lagi. And they still write. Okay. Masa sudah tamat, they still write. Okay, this, if possible, try to do. You have to be very, you have to practice your time management now. Make sure, if possible, the last 5 minutes is for you to go back to your section A, read through section A. Did I do it? Okay, I'm happy. Okay, done. Then go through section B. Did I do it well? Okay, I'm happy. So then you can just put them together. Okay, because this is a booklet, so you can just close the book, okay, and just relax for 1 or 2 minutes before before the invigilator tells you that time's up. Okay, so if you ask me, such a lengthy explanation, but the answer would be, my suggestion would be to do section A first. Okay, all right.
Thank you so much for the explanation, Teacher Najima, and I hope Nuhan and all the students out there, okay, you have a clearer point of view. You now can do well. You can do better for your continuous writing, especially. I just would like to add, something, Teacher Najima, because you mentioned about even if you can only write 200 words, that's fine as long as you don't leave the paper blank. Yeah. But remember again, kids, structure. All right, make sure at least you have introduction, body, and closure. Yeah. All right. So at least that shows that you have a structure and you know how to write an essay. Okay? All right. So thank you so much, Teacher Najima and everyone. We're going to have 15 minutes break. And I'll see you again at 10:15 for paper 2. All right. Enjoy your break and see you later. Thank you, Teacher Najima.
Thank you, everyone. See you later.
Pernahkah anda terfikir untuk belajar skill baru tapi tak tahu nak cari kat mana? Bayaran mahal. Bila jumpa yang sesuai, alahai, tempat kursus jauhnya. Memperkenalkan planetmahir.com. Planet Mahir adalah platform pembelajaran online dalam bahasa Melayu yang pertama di dunia. Ianya murah dan senang nak akses. Melalui Planet Mahir, anda boleh belajar pelbagai skill yang anda mahu. Anda boleh memilih dari ratusan skill daripada instruktor-instruktor yang berpengalaman dan tersohor. Nak belajar cara buat mobile app hebat? Menyanyi macam Siti Nurhaliza? Nak berniaga tapi tak tahu mula macam mana? Usah risau. Di Planet Mahir, kami menyediakan kursus-kursus yang anda boleh pilih satu-satu atau terus bandelkan semua kursus yang anda mahu. Ataupun anda nak buat duit mengajar orang lain. Senang saja. Cuma create account anda, muat naik video dan bahan pembelajaran dan pilih berapa harga anda nak jual. Di Planet Mahir, anda boleh belajar apa sahaja, mengajar apa sahaja. Anytime, anywhere. Start learning, start earning.
Jadi
kenapa
pulang lagi ya? Okay, soalan nombor 2 yang popular.
Negatif 3 dan negatif 3 kuasa 2. So kita dapat apa? Negatif negatif 3 kuasa 2.
Jadi akan menjadi
jadi sama-sama kita tumpukan perhatian kepada teori kinetik ciri. Okey.
Dan agak percaya di
kita
pun
ajaran yang seperti ini. Kami kena ingat dia diberi gelaran penyelamat umat Islam. Ingat yang itu.
Bandingan berkaitan perempuan yang panjang Maharaja Leda.
Dia ni dia berdiri kat tengah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh everyone and welcome to Mahir Teacher. Hi, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh everyone and welcome to Mahir Tutor.
Mempelajari fizik sebenarnya membantu kita memahami apa yang jadi di alam semesta. Okay, apa yang jadi dalam dunia. Kita boleh mempelajari banyak perkara dalam dunia ini berkait dengan fizik. Bila kita bercakap, ia adalah fizik. Bila kita berjalan, ia adalah fizik. Semua yang melibatkan kehidupan ini adalah fizik. Panjang 12 tahun saya menjadi tutor, kita dah membantu ribuan pelajar untuk mencapai keputusan yang cemerlang dalam fizik SPM. Saya Cikgu Ajwat. Ada 4 masalah utama yang menjadi masalah besar kepada pelajar yang menyebabkan pelajar tak suka fizik. So, saya mengendalikan bengkel di Selangor dan juga jemputan dari negeri-negeri lain dan juga jemputan-jemputan sekolah untuk bantu lebih ramai pelajar untuk skor dalam fizik SPM. Dengan menyertai kelas saya di planetmahir.com, anda akan mempelajari yang fizik ini sebenarnya mudah, santai dan menyeronokkan. Bila dah rasa seronok nak belajar fizik, barulah senang nak dapat A. Tapi kenalah usaha juga kan? Selalunya pelajar ingat yang fizik ni terlalu banyak konsep, prinsip dan hukum yang perlu diingat. Okay, masalah mengira sebenarnya bukanlah masalah fizik. Jom, jumpa saya di planetmahir.com, gedung ilmu online.
Sains ialah berasal dari perkataan scientia dalam bahasa Latin yang bermaksud pengetahuan. Okay. Jadi dari segi istilah, sains ialah kajian sistematik mengenai fenomena semula jadi yang berlaku di sekeliling kita. Okay, masalah yang dialami oleh pelajar ialah mereka menganggap bahawa subjek sains itu susah dan terlalu banyak fakta yang perlu diingat. Sebenarnya, pelajar perlu tukar mindset dengan menganggap bahawa sains ni sebenarnya sangat mudah dan menyeronokkan. Saya Cikgu Farhana berpengalaman mengajar subjek sains hampir 15 tahun bagi peringkat sekolah rendah dan menengah. Oleh kerana mempunyai minat yang mendalam dalam bidang ini, Cikgu telah menyambung pengajian dalam bidang sains biologi di UPM. Dalam kursus ini, Cikgu akan berkongsi dengan semua pelajar bagaimana untuk kita belajar sains dengan lebih seronok, mudah dan berkesan. Kita tak boleh nak hafal semata-mata. Okey, apa yang penting adalah memahami suatu konsep sains tu. Jadi seterusnya, kita dapat belajar cara, teknik, tips, contohnya seperti kata kunci, macam mana nak lukis gambar. So, semua benda tu cikgu akan kongsikan dengan semua pelajar. Saya, Cikgu Farhana, akan membawa anda menjelajah ke dunia sains yang menyeronokkan dan jumpa anda di Mahir Tutor.
Tahukah kamu bahawa Persekutuan Tanah Melayu telah mendapat kemerdekaan kerana Tunku Abdul Rahman telah menekan butang merah? Apa itu butang merah? Semuanya cikgu akan rungkaikan dalam kelas sejarah cikgu.
Kita adalah insan menumpang atas dunia. Aku dengan caraku yang sederhana.
Hai, saya Cikgu Rafi. Mari belajar sejarah secara santai dan menyeronokkan. Kenapa kita perlu belajar sejarah? Sejarah akan memberi kita pemahaman tentang peristiwa pada masa lalu. Begitu juga berkaitan dengan teladan dan juga iktibar yang kita boleh perolehi daripada peristiwa-peristiwa pada masa lalu. Cikgu telah mengajar hampir 19 tahun daripada tingkatan 1 hingga tingkatan 5 dan kebanyakan pelajar selalu menghadapi masalah untuk memahami sejarah. Cikgu akan pastikan anda semua memahami sejarah secara santai bersama cikgu. Cikgu akan mengajar bagaimana mengingati kata kunci-kata kunci dalam pelbagai topik. Selain daripada itu, cikgu juga akan mengajar bagaimana untuk kita tembak dalam menjawab kertas-kertas soalan objektif. Jadi, ikuti kelas Cikgu Rafi dalam subjek sejarah SPM di Mahir Tutor.
Rasulullah SAW pernah bersabda, menuntut ilmu itu wajib ke atas individu Muslim. Hadis riwayat Ibnu Majah. Kesilapan yang sering dilihat pada pelajar dalam menjawab soalan pendidikan Islam adalah mereka menghafal tanpa memahami. Sekiranya kamu menghafal dan tidak memahami, kamu tidak akan dapat menjawab untuk soalan berbentuk penerangan. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. Saya Cikgu Ayu, merupakan graduan daripada Universiti Malaya dalam jurusan pengajian Islam. Saya pernah berkhidmat sebagai guru pembimbing di salah sebuah sekolah di Shah Alam dalam mata pelajaran pendidikan Islam. Berdasarkan pengalaman saya selama 5 tahun di sekolah tersebut, saya dapat lihat bagaimana kelemahan yang ada pada mereka. Dan apabila telah diajar dengan teknik dan cara menjawab yang betul, daripada grade C ke D, mereka telah berubah kepada grade B dan juga A. Melalui kelas ini, cikgu akan kongsikan cara untuk mengingat kata kunci yang mudah dan juga bagaimana cara untuk menjawab soalan kebat yang betul dan semestinya tajuk yang dijangka masuk dalam peperiksaan sebenar. Saya Cikgu Ayu, guru pendidikan Islam anda. Temui saya di Mahir Tutor.
Hi everyone, welcome back and I hope you had a good quick break for 15 minutes and I know all of you are excited to continue our session as teacher Najima, our guru cemerlang bahasa Inggeris and she is also guru kanan mata pelajaran bahasa from Sekolah Menengah Kebangsaan Lelaki Bukit Bintang will be sharing the next tips which are for paper 2. Yeah, teacher Najima? So yes, please welcome teacher Najima.
Okay. Hello everyone, welcome back. Now we are going to look at paper 2. Okay, paper 2 is actually very popular among all SPM candidates because they don't have to write much, okay? It's basically, it's there, you just answer. But one thing I would say about paper 2 is candidates take it very lightly. They just tick A, just tick B, and then you just write a few lines. Okay, for novel and it's done. No, actually paper 2, if you are weak in paper 1, paper 2 is what is going to help you. Okay, so for candidates out there, if you are weak in paper 1, if you feel you are so stressed with paper 1 because you are not good in essay, then don't worry. Paper 2 is here to help you. Okay, so now I'll be going through paper two with you. I'll be sharing a few tips with you. I hope that will help you to do better in paper two, to top up, bahasa kata top up, to top up paper one, so that you will be able to get a very good mark, or the mark, or the grade that you wish to get for your SPM English language paper. Yeah. Okay. Right. Now, if we look at paper two, it is a paper for 2 hours and 15 minutes, and we are looking at 70 marks. So in a way, I can say that maybe 35 to 40 marks is there, is already for you to take, okay? If you feel you are not good in this part or you're not good in this part. But I think around 35 to 40 marks, yeah, you can still get it, okay? If you get more, then of course, okay, you are on your way to A lah, all right? So we have four sections. We have 15 marks for section A, 10 marks for section B, 25 marks for section C, and another 20 marks for section D. Okay, right. Now, let's focus on section A first. Okay, now. Okay, maybe just to try. Okay, I know I've been talking and you've been listening. So why don't all of you just read this question and just try to, just try to write out what would be the answer for this. Okay, maybe I will give you 1 or 2 minutes. All right. Okay, in a exam situation, yeah, when you get this type of questions, my advice to you is to read that particular extract or that particular content for at least, I must try to read it twice. Please write, read it twice. Why? Because the first time you read, maybe you don't really get it, yeah? So read again the second time. Once you read the second time, only then you look at the question and then you try to identify which would be the answer. Okay, my worry with candidates is that they read it once, they read the choice, and then straight away they will say, oh, okay, this is the answer. But when we check again, the answer is wrong. Why? When I ask my students, why? Why did you get it wrong? Oh, teacher, I didn't read this word. I missed this word. Why? Because they were in a hurry to complete the question. They don't want to take the time. It's 2 hours and 15 minutes, okay? It's long, okay? Many candidates say, teacher, the paper is very long. It's long for a reason. There is a reason why this paper is, you are given 2 hours and 15 minutes. Why? Because it's a lot of reading. And I think even for me, sometimes I have to read it twice, sometimes three times. Okay, so there is a reason why this paper is 2 hours and 15 minutes. Candidates out there, please take the time to read. Please read it again. If you don't understand, look at the choices you have and then choose the answer that you think is the right answer. So for this particular question, what is it required of you? You have to read the letter and locate the main idea of the letter. So the answer is D. So if you answered D just now, okay, very good, excellent, well done. Okay, that means you can identify, you can actually locate the main idea correctly. Very good. Okay, these are the types of questions. So what does section A requires you to do? It can ask you to locate the main idea. And if you look at this question, okay, again, it wants you to identify how the DIY taste check can help them. So every question that is given to you, there is a objective there. It wants you to do what? So just now it was to locate the main idea. This question, it wants you to identify how the DIY taste check can help. All right. So again, I think compared to the question I showed you just now, this one is, there are more information. So you need more time. This one, you cannot read it in 2 minutes and answer. I think you will need more time. Maybe 3 to 4 minutes. Read one by one, and then there's a possibility you don't understand the meaning of the word regulate. Okay, you might not understand some of the word, maybe dehydration, you don't understand. So you need time. You need time to think, okay, what does this word mean? Don't take too much time, by the way. All right. Just because it's 2 hours and 15 minutes, when I say you have a lot of time, it doesn't mean you can pause. Okay. Think for 5 minutes and then come back. No such thing. You read again, look at the question. You have to read again another time, read again. Okay. That's all I mean. I don't mean you can just sit there and look and think and then continue. No time, candidates. Okay. Question number three, right? Turn your smartphone into an ATM card. Okay. So this one, if you look at the number of lines that you have to read is less compared to question one, the first and the second question. But this one, what do you have to do? Required to read the advertisement on turning a handphone into an ATM and decide which of the four statements of the advertisement was true. Okay, so the correct answer was option D. So the answer is D. Even if it only has a few lines, candidates, but the requirement is for you to read carefully and decide which statement is true. So although it's only four lines, but it doesn't mean it is easy. You still have to read again. Okay, is this correct? Oh, this is wrong. Okay, this one, is this correct? Oh, this is wrong. Okay, this one looks like correct. Oh, no. This is also wrong. Oh, the correct answer is D. This takes time, candidate. So you need to don't panic. You have to be calm, answer one by one, and then identify which is correct, which is wrong. And I'm sure you will be able to identify or get the correct answer. Okay. Now, when you look at section A, question 1 to 8, are the questions that will be like this, all right? Then you have question 9 to 15, okay? Which would be like this. This is what we call rational close. Now, in this particular section, what you are being tested would be more of the language part, okay? I will show you now, okay? You see? Life is not easy when you are terrified of electricity, as one woman called Dana knows all too well. If she gets, okay, there's a dash here, a light. So you are given choices here. All right. And then you have to fit in which particular, okay, preposition here would be the right one. So what do? You take A, you try. Okay, this is for the weak ones. There are some candidates out there, the moment they see the choices, they know this is the answer. But there are some candidates out there who might be weak. They're not sure. They don't know. It's okay. You take the words, you put it in the sentence. Okay, sometimes you will know it sounds right. Okay, how? Well, I don't have much time to explain very detailed how. But when you put that word into the sentence, you know it sounds right. Okay, so that is the answer. But in this particular question, what is being tested? You are being tested on preposition. So now you still have time. You can do some revision on prepositions. What are prepositions? Okay. Or when are they used? Okay. So you take this time to do some revision on prepositions. Okay. Next. For Donna's extreme condition was electrophobia, or the method fear of electricity. So what are you being tested? Vocabulary. Remember just now I told you in paper one, vocabulary is very important. Okay, vocabulary will help you to convey the meaning. That means people will understand you exactly the way you want them to understand you. The wrong choice of word would mean a totally different thing. So in this particular question, vocabulary is being tested as well. All right. So for this, now that you still have time, do some revision on vocabulary as well. How do I do revision on vocabulary? Okay, what should I do, teacher? Okay, what can you do? Read. Okay, I know it's very difficult for some of you. You just feel you don't have time. Don't have to find all those thick books out there. The simplest way you can read is newspaper. Teacher, I don't have time to go and buy newspaper. Never mind, go online. Teacher, go online, what am I supposed to read? Okay, there are newspapers out there, okay? There are newspapers online. Read the right, okay, material, yeah, candidates, all right? I don't want you to go online and read, okay, unnecessary materials that will not be helpful to you, all right? But there are so many ways you can improve your vocabulary. Another way would be just to do some more exercises. The simplest way would be to do some exercises on vocabulary. Go to past year questions, okay, and do all the rational close questions. Or you can even ask your teacher for help. Okay, teacher, can you give me more questions on a rational close? I want to try. Go ahead, okay, do that. Practice makes perfect. Okay, the list of phobias is growing every day. And now, okay, that's underline number 11. Online ad, okay. So here, what is being tested? Tense. Okay, past tense, present tense. Okay, past continuous tense, present continuous tense. Tenses, there's a lot of tense. I mean, if you ask, students will always say, teacher, so many tenses to remember. Okay? What one thing you can do to improve would be do more practice. Okay, do more practice and you can ask your teachers for help. All right? I'm sure the candidates out there, you are from various schools. So you can ask your teachers for help. You can ask them to explain to you, teacher, what does this mean? What simple tense is how, teacher? Some might be asking that question. Cikgu, simple tense to apa? This one is what, teacher? Okay, ask your teachers for help. So for this section, okay, tenses will also be tested. Okay, here, adverb of time. So adjectives, adverbs, so what we are looking at. So make sure you do revision on adjectives, adverbs. Okay, you must do all, you must do revisions on all that lah. All right, okay. All right, now, what is this? Okay, this is parts of speech. Okay, sometimes pronouns will be tested. Okay, verb will be tested. So, okay, pronouns. Okay, verbs, okay, can be tested. All right, as mentioned just now, adverbs, adjectives, okay. So, okay, aspects of language would be tested. Okay, now, here comes the easiest, I would say this is one of the easiest part of paper two. Because why am I saying it's the easiest part? I always tell my students it's the concept of copy and paste. Information transfer is all about copy and paste. You must, but the trick is to copy the right one and to paste it correctly. Okay? So the concept is copy and paste. C and P. All right? Okay. Now, you see here, okay, this particular candidate, again, is from Kupasan Mutu Soalan, SPM 2017. Okay, so here, okay, you are given this short extract, and then it's for you to fill up, okay? These five questions is for you to complete. Okay, so where do you get all this information? Where do you get it from? It's from here, okay? Oh, I didn't copy that part. Okay, never mind. All right, okay. So the answers would be in the extract given. So you have to choose and write. Now, I want to remind you, candidates, if what is given in the text is capital words, for example, this is an example, title of movies, all right, and it's all in capital letter. Let's say it says Avengers. Okay. And then it says Superman. If you see all in capital, my advice to you is copy and paste. So if it's all in capital, when you transfer your answer, it must be capital as well. All right? If it's like this, okay, you have a mix, okay? If it's all in small letters, then you write in small letters as well. Okay? Remember the concept of copy and paste. All right? Whatever you see, you read, you think that is the answer, you choose that answer, then you transfer to the place it's supposed to be in. Okay? Right. Now, the same goes here. Now, for 2017, the candidates were supposed to complete the boxes here. They are supposed to label parts of a shoe. Okay, so as you can see, this one, all the answers were correct because the candidate was able to label the parts of the shoe correctly. Okay, and they took note of the instruction that they should only fill the boxes with no more than two words. Okay, this is another thing. Now, when you read the question for section B, make sure you read. There will be a small statement given where make sure you answer the question no more than three words, no more than two words. Please take note of this. No more than two words. That means anything that is more than two is wrong. Okay, anything that is more than two is wrong. So teacher, one can. If the answer is only one word, then okay. Okay, if the answer is two words, then okay. But if you tell me the answer is three words, when the question already say the answer must be no more than two words, then it's wrong. Okay, it's wrong. Okay, so even if you say, but teacher, first word and second word is correct, the third word is wrong, teacher. So these two can accept lah. No, cannot. Ah, because why? The instruction says no more than two words. So we stick to that. Read the instruction. Okay, candidates. Okay. All right. So that's all for section B. Yeah. Now we come to section C. Section C is very, very, for some candidates is easy. For some candidates is very stressful. For some candidates, they just do whatever they want to do and then they will leave most of the parts blank. No. Okay, no, don't. Why? Because it's there. Everything is there to help you. What you should do would be to read. Now, let me show you. Okay. Before I continue with what I wanted to say, let's look at this first. Okay. There are five main questions consisting of nine parts. Okay. This is SPM 2000. This is a general one. Okay. Sorry. There were five main questions consisting of nine parts. Question 26, 27. Okay. Mere recall items. Okay. If it's mere recall items, that means the question will ask you to go back to the paragraph. The answer will be there. So you just take the right answer and you write out. Okay? Question 30. Okay, usually question number 28 and 29 apply higher order comprehension skill. Okay, what does this mean would be? Question 28 and 29, it might need you to maybe give, what do you think? Okay, based on this word, it refers to who? So it's like you have to read again and see who does it refer to. So it's a slightly more of a higher order. Okay, you have to refer. It's not directly there, but you have to refer and try to see whether this is the person that this question is, whether this is the answer for that particular question. Okay, but question number 30 is definitely a personal response question. Okay, personal response. That means as long as it's logical, it makes sense, then your answer is correct. Okay, but make sure that your answer is relevant to the text. Lah. All right. Now, to answer the comprehension questions, read the questions first. Okay, some candidates, they like to read the text first. Fine. Okay, if you do that, that's fine. But if you are someone who is weak, okay, or I wouldn't say weak, lah. So you're not very proficient in the language, okay, then what you must do, read the question first. Why must I read the question first when I have not even read the text? It's because reading the question will give you an idea. Oh, okay. This passage is going to be about this. Oh, okay. These are the things that I have to look into as I'm reading the text. Okay? So, read the question first. Then what must you do? Why must you do this? It helps you to focus. There is a focus. There's a reason why you are reading. Okay, some candidates, they like to read first. Even in my students, some of them, they like to read first. Fine. I'm not saying that's wrong. But if you want to do this way, it's also possible. Okay? When you answer the question, you can copy the relevant parts of the sentences. Yes, okay? We will see in a minute. If the question say word, okay, please, candidates, please take note of this. Word means it's only one word. Okay, candidates, it's only one. Phrase It can be 2 to 4 words. It can be in the beginning, middle, or end. It in a sentence. In a sentence, ah, phrase means what should my, what must you do? Okay, you refer to the sentence that you think the answer is in. Refer to the sentence. Okay, you refer to the sentence first. Then the question say phrase. Then you identify. Okay, this answer. The phrase is it in the first four? Is it in the second four? Is it in the last four? It might be 3. It might be 4. Okay. It might be even 2, 3, 4. Okay, but it's not one. If the question say phrase, it's not one. Nah, it's more than one, but not the whole sentence. Okay, all right. Now, pay attention to the keywords and the WH questions. Yes. Okay, all right. Pay attention to the paragraphs. Okay, this is the wonderful, wonderful thing about comprehension. Why I'm saying it's wonderful? Because the paragraphs are given. Based on paragraph 1, based on paragraph 2, based on paragraph 3. So, when you read the question, it's already telling you, okay, for this question, please look at paragraph 1. Okay, for this question, please look at paragraph 2. So, it's already given to you. So, pay attention to that as well. And, okay, pronoun use. Okay, now, what is this particular bullet trying to tell you is, if the question is, if the, in the passage, it says I, okay? I am very popular, I. But when you answer, you cannot use the word I. You have to change it to he, she, the writer, okay? So you have to change, you have to do that change. You cannot transfer I and your answer is also I. No, cannot, not accepted. All right, okay. All right, now this is a sample first, before we do the SPM 2018. Okay, so here you have one paragraph, okay, of the text. This is SPM 2017, but later I will show you SPM 2018, okay? Now, this is the text, all right, now. So, sorry. Okay, from paragraph one, which two activities? So, if I'm the candidate, I'm going to answer, okay. I will say, okay, now, okay, for this question, number one, I must look at paragraph one. Okay, then two activities. Did watching television prevent? Okay, prevent Jeffrey and Maria from doing. Okay, I might be someone very weak. I don't understand the meaning of the word prevent. It's okay. Okay, so now let's go to prevent. Two activities. Did watching television prevent? Okay, so now, okay, I will read. Okay. I'm not going to read to you now, so everybody you can read and then see where the answer would be. Okay, what did it stop them from doing? Okay, they agreed. All right. Mm-hmm. So the answer would be here. Okay, it will not be in paragraph 2 or 3, so it would be here. So you would have to read, okay, and see where the answer would be. Okay, but to help you today, now for now, okay, it's already giving you the answer. All right, mention the activity. So, activity one, reading, activity two, gardening. All right, so it's very direct. The answer is there, they just take. Okay, now, next question. What finally made them give up television? This question requires candidates to give the reason why. Okay. Okay, don't worry. Question 26, the answer is still in the passage. Okay, so this one candidate straight away gave the answer cholesterol results. The other candidate actually wrote the whole sentence. But because the answer is still there, this candidate is able to get the mark. Okay. All right, what about this? Okay, I want to attract straight away go to this particular, sorry, okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, you are looking at everything that you should look at later. Okay, all right. Now, okay, question number 27. From paragraph 3, what impressed local residents about Jeffrey and Maria's garden? Okay, again, this question requires the candidate to identify the reason why the neighbors were impressed. So again, the answer is in the text, is in the paragraph, okay? Now, there is this question that my students ask me, teacher, if I don't know the answer, can I leave it blank? Okay, if I don't know the answer, I read, teacher, I read and I read. I don't know the answer, teacher. Can I leave it blank? My question to that particular student would be, why do you want to leave it blank? Okay, why? The answer, you don't know the answer. Okay, I understand you don't know the answer. But how sure are you the answer that you want to write is wrong? Okay, so my advice is, even if you think you don't know the answer, but if you think maybe this is the answer, just write. You never know. That might be the right answer. Okay? Don't underestimate yourself to the extent that you just want to leave it blank. I really think that is not the right way to go. Even if you don't know the answer, if you think that is the right answer, just write. You never know. That might be the answer. Okay? And then, if you have done it before, you left it blank, and then your teacher tells you this is the answer, there will be students who say, teacher, I thought that is the answer, but I was not confident, so I didn't write. See, dah hilang markah. Just like that. Okay, no, don't. Just write. Just write, candidates. Okay. Okay. Which word? This is the one, very popular in SPM. Word, phrase, sentence. Okay. But nowadays, it's either word or phrase. Okay. Which word means encouragement to start something new? So the word springboard. Okay, let's say the candidate did not write this word. Just write the word springboard. Is the answer correct? Yes. And then there are candidates who say, teacher, if I don't put this, is it okay? The inverted, is it okay? Yeah, as long as the answer is there, it's fine. Okay, even if you don't have this the word or you don't have the inverted, it's okay. Okay, your answer is still correct. Okay, now. This is the personal response, question number 30. How do you think Maria and Jeffrey's friend reacted when they first decided to give up watching television? Okay, friend's reaction, reason. Okay, I would like to inform you that, let's say the reason is correct, the reaction is wrong. So, zero. Okay, let's say the reaction is correct, but the reason is not logical. Because here, it's 2 marks. So please take note. Okay, these two goes together. Okay, so this one and this part, this friend's reaction and reason comes together. So it is 2 marks. Okay, so this and this must be related. Okay, and it must be relevant to the text as well. Okay, now, summary. Okay. For summary, you must read the summary question carefully. Exactly. No matter what the question is, you must read the question carefully. Draw a box. Okay, I will show you in a minute. Draw a box. Example, use material from line 55 to 31. Okay, some candidates, they will say, teacher, I don't like drawing a box. I think I know. But based on my personal experience, there are times when the text might be too challenging. Okay, and you are already stressed. Okay, because you don't understand a lot of things in the text. And then you don't do the box. Why is the box important? Okay, teacher, why are you asking me to draw a box? The box is important because it tells you, okay, this is all that is. You work within this only. Up, down, not important. Okay, so you work within this box only. So it gives you a focus. So that is why I always tell my students, and I think I want to tell you too, please, okay, draw a box. There's nothing, it's okay to draw a box because the paper, the examiners or whoever is, the examiners, they won't get upset if they see a box there. All right, okay. Now, the third bullet. Okay, there are candidates who have been told that they can draw a box like this one, okay? Okay, so they draw a box. And then they write one word in one box. All right? One word, one box. One word. Okay. This is also, it's okay. You can do this. You can do this. Okay? But there are candidates, even my students, some of them, they say they don't like boxes. They like to write it as it is. They don't like to do boxes. They think boxes make them feel stressed writing the summary. Fine. That is also okay. But candidates, please remember, it must be in one paragraph and it must only be 130 words. 130 words, including the 10 words given candidates. So 130 words minus the 10 words given. So you only look for 120 words. Okay. Now, teacher, what happens if I write more? The answer is very obvious. Okay. The answer is very clear. When you write more than 130 words, of course, okay, the examiner will stop reading after, I mean, they won't read after the 130th word. Okay, so the 131 is already out of the line. So even for me, I won't read anymore. I will stop at 130. That's why it's very important. That's why 2 hours and 15 minutes is actually not that long. Okay, if you look at it this way. All right. Okay. You must write the 10 words given. Okay, this is another problem that we have sometimes, where candidates, they look for the content point. They know that is the content point, and they straight away start writing. Okay, without writing out the 10 words given. What happens? What happens is that particular content point is not going to be counted as a content point. Why? Because that content point is standing on its own without any sentence to begin with, all right? It is on its own. It's standing without anything, all right? You need a sentence. Content point comes in a form of a sentence. But you write your first content point without copying the 10 words given. So there is nothing to support this particular content point. And therefore, you are actually giving away. Kena guna bahasa sedekah. Okay, you sedekah 1 mark. Because you don't want to write the first 10 words, okay? No time for sedekah here. You have to make sure you get as many marks as you can, candidates. Okay. Next, you must try to identify the 10 content points. Okay. Summary is 10 marks for content. Maximum 10 content points. Okay, teacher. What happens if I have 12? Can I write? Teacher, I have 13 content points. Can I write? Yes, you can write. Within the 130 words, okay? You must make sure the 10 content points is in the 130 words, okay? Oh, you only have 120 words. You count, you will have 120 words. Oh, I can add one more content point. Add one more. But before you add, you count the content points first. How many content points are here? Oh, 9 words. So here 120, 9, 129. Okay, can, right. Okay? But you have 11. You have one more content point waiting. You count, 130. You have one more. Can I add? Don't. Why? More than 130 words. Okay, I hope you understand. I hope I'm not too fast. Okay? Right. Underline or highlight the content points. Now, it's okay to underline in the paper, in the question paper. You can underline. Okay? Underline or highlight. It doesn't matter. You can do it. Okay? Just underline or highlight. Some candidates, they are afraid to use colored pen. You can, okay? It's your paper, right? But don't write your answer using the colored pen, candidates, okay? You can underline the content points using the colored pen if you want, but when you write your answer, it must be in blue pen or usually blue, okay? Make it blue, all right? Okay. Do not include elaborations, okay? When you do content point, you look out for the main content points. Don't look at the elaboration, okay? Do not include examples. Examples, you don't need examples. Content point means zoom into the main. Okay, main, only the main part of the what is required. Okay, don't look at the examples. Don't look at the elaboration. And I mentioned this just now. Do not exceed 130 words. Okay, now, this is SPM 2018. Okay, it's about Sarah, a surfer. Okay, now, you look at this question. Okay, I hope you can see. Okay, all right. Which one word in paragraph 2 tells us that Sarah's father was one of the earliest surfer in Malaysia? One word, candidates. One word. Okay, which one word tells in paragraph 2 tells us that Sarah's father was one of the earliest surfers? So what should you do? So you go to paragraph 2. Okay, you read. Okay. Okay. So which word tells you that which word tells you that the father was one of the earlier surfers? Okay, the word pioneer. Okay, the word pioneer. Let me see. Okay, the word pioneer. This is the word pioneer. So you write pioneer. Okay. So teacher, do I have to have the open close inverted? If you have, it's okay. But even if you just write the word pioneer, your answer is correct. So that is what you should do from paragraph three. So look at paragraph three. Okay. Which two phrases? So you read and then you identify two word phrase. This is very helpful now. Two word phrase. So it is telling you the answer is only two words. Two word phrase. So you read and then you identify the two word phrase that is going to answer the question. So that is why I say there's no reason why you should leave comprehension blank, because it is giving you the help in terms of the paragraphs. And the questions are, in a way, helping you to locate the answer. Okay? Right. Now, let's look at this one. Okay. So here, your own suggest one way to encourage your classmates to take up serving. So how to encourage? Reason. So this comes together. Okay? So you have one mark here, one mark here. So if here is irrelevant, automatically here will be irrelevant as well lah. Okay, usually there might be some special cases, but generally if here, then sometimes it here and here it doesn't match. Okay, so you will not get the mark. Okay, based on the passage, write a summary on. Okay, summary, this is what I was talking about just now. Here the question has two parts. What Sarah did to become one of the best surfers in Malaysia. So here you have part one. And the challenges Sarah and other surface experienced, part two. So the content point that you are going to locate would have to have content points for the first part and the second part. Okay. Your summary must be in continuous writing form, not note form. Okay. Please take note that everything that you write will be in one paragraph. And then use materials from lines 5 to 31. So this is what I said. Make a box. Line 5, where is line 5? Okay, 5. Line 31, okay, 30, 31. Okay, make a box. Okay, making a box is very important. Okay, no longer than 130 words, including the 10 words given. So I told you the maths just now, 120 minus 10, so you have 120. All right, okay. Begin your summary. Okay, I'm rushing it a bit because I have literature to cover, yeah? Okay, begin your summary. So you write out the 10 words given. Oh, so here, Sarah, okay, you have to write this out. Even in SPM, you write this out, the 10 words given, and then you continue with the content point, okay? Okay, the content point. All right, okay. So this all we've discussed. Okay, now we come to the last section, section D. All right, now, poem, we have four. Okay, we don't know which particular poem will be tested this year. So it's very important for you to do revision for all four poems. Okay, now. So what is important is you understand the poem. You know what it is about. You know more or less you get the overview what the poem is about. All right, so that you'll be able to answer the questions. Actually, question one will be a direct one. Okay, it's here. Okay, this one would be your personal response. Okay, so here you two marks is in your hand. Here one mark is in your hand. The challenging one might be number two, B and C. Okay, so 3 out of 5 is better than 0 out of 5. Okay, so it's there. You just have to locate and think a little bit in order to answer that question. Okay, now this one. Novel, okay. I hope all of you have read the novel that you are studying, all right? Because different parts of Malaysia, we have different novels, yeah? Like Selangor, we are doing Dear Mr. Kilmer, all right? So maybe for you, it's a different novel, lah. But by now, you must know the plot or story of the novel, all right? You must know the characters and characteristics. You must know the important events. You must know the moral values. Because why? Because usually the questions, more or less, okay, plot will definitely be there. Characters, definitely you will have to include. events, when you talk about characters, automatically it will link to the events. And moral value along the way, you might have to say, he became a better person. Okay, so indirectly, all these are tied up together. All right, okay, now. This is a very simple template, excuse me, that I give my students, lah, all right? When you write, just make a short intro. Two lines is okay. You are telling the examiner, this is the novel I'm going to talk about, and this is the question that I'm going to answer. So in the novel, Dear Mr. Kilmer, so I'm mentioning the novel by who? I'm mentioning the author. There are many in these incidents that clearly indicate that we must have the courage to do the right thing. Where did I get this? I'm getting it from here. So I'm telling, indirectly, I'm telling the person who is marking my paper, the examiner, that this is the novel, and this is the question that I'm going to answer. Teacher, it's a very short intro. It's okay. We are not giving the answer here. We are just telling the reader, this is what, this is the question, and here, this is the novel I'm going to work with. That's all. Here is where it starts. So the second paragraph is where you start. Okay, the first incident, because we must, based on the novel, provide incidents. So the first incident, so again, I'm highlighting the question here. Okay, I'm specifying the incident here, and I'm giving the evidence and example here. So every paragraph, make sure you have, you specify the incident and you give evidence and example. That's why, candidate, if you don't read the novel, you will not be able to give evidence, you will not be able to give example. So you need to know what the plot is all about so that you can support what you are saying, okay? Right. Okay. All right. So this is basically a very simple template lah, that I prepare, especially for those of you who are not very confident. So you must have a 5-paragraph answer for novel. Introduction, maybe 1 or 2 lines, as I mentioned just now. Paragraph 2, 3, 4 is where the whole answer will be, okay? Paragraph 2, you give 1 reason, then support it with evidence, elaboration, example. Evidence, elaboration plus example. Then you go to paragraph 3 again. So this will be the second, okay? The second reason, and here it will be the third reason. All right? So you have 1, and then you have 3, okay, and then you have a very short conclusion based on the novel, based on all my answer, all my explanation, based on all my elaboration examples above, it's very clear why I feel Mr. Kilmer is a very important character in this novel, for example. All right? Okay. Right. Okay, I'm sorry if I rushed it a little bit, all right? But I would like to thank everyone for your attention. Thank you very much. It has been a pleasure sharing my knowledge with all of you, all right? And I know that all of you might be a bit stressed at the moment, trying to catch up as much as you can. But don't worry. All you can do is try your best, think positive, and I'm sure, okay? I'm very, very sure that you will reach your destination safely and well. Okay, so with that, I think I have to end my lesson now. So I will send, now it's back to Teacher Z lah. Thank you.
Hi, thank you, Teacher Najima. So how is everyone doing after listening to we had 2 sessions with Teacher Najima. The first session in the morning, she shared with us a lot of tips for you to actually score and excel paper 1. And she just ended the session by sharing with us lots of informative information on paper 2. So let's take a look at the questions if you have. By the way, Teacher Najima, because we know that we have different novels, right?
Yes.
Okay. For example, in Selangor, they are learning Dear Mr. Kilmer.
Yes.
Okay. Are they allowed to choose other novels?
Okay. All right. Okay. Now,
If let's say they are readers and they have read all the novels and they decide to write other, to answer based on other novels, not Dear Mr. Kilmer.
Okay. All right. My response to that would be, a particular novel has been assigned to you, okay? And your teacher has been discussing a lot about that particular novel, all right? Mm-mm. With the characters. So I'm sure even when you do your questions, your teacher will be focusing on that particular novel. So if you were to challenge yourself now suddenly to do a totally different novel, I think it's, for you ask me personally, I would say it's a very risky thing. Right? Because all the knowledge that the teacher, I mean, all the practice that you have done is focusing on one particular novel. So if you ask me, I would say, why now? Why do it now? Okay. Just stick to that particular novel and just do it as I'm sure how your teachers have informed you how you should go about it.
Thank you, Teacher Najima. Okay, we have a question from Sharifa Al-Qudsi. Teacher Najima, can I write a short synopsis in the introduction for the novel? I think this is a really good question.
A short synopsis, okay. Okay, you can write a short synopsis, but don't get carried away with the synopsis that you don't, you are not answering the question. Okay, as I said, for those candidates who are weak, a one or two line intro would be fine. Okay, but if you are someone who have that command of the language to write more for intro, go ahead. All right, but don't make that your priority that you don't answer the question.
Thank you. And we have another question from Najwa Zinira. Her question is on summary. How to get more marks for a language in summary?
Okay. Now, I'm sure if teachers would usually tell you the easiest way to score 3 marks for summary would be to take out the content point and join them together. All right? Join them into one paragraph and you will get your 3 marks. If you want more, which is 4 or 5, you would have to use this technique called paraphrasing. You have to paraphrase without changing the meaning. Okay? Not only do you paraphrase, you must make sure when you paraphrase the sentence, the meaning still is still the same. The problem that some candidates have is sometimes they paraphrase to the extent that when you look back at the content, the original content point, the meaning is different. All right. So if you want to try paraphrasing, I would advise you to try it now and show it to your teachers so that your teachers would be able to guide you and tell you whether you should go that way, whether you should start paraphrasing the content points. This is not a problem for those candidates who are very excellent with the language, but especially for those who are not very confident, then you, maybe you can try, give it to your teacher. And then your teacher will guide you whether you should go go on paraphrasing or just stick to the basic way of doing summary.
All right, thank you. And another question from Nur Shafika. This is regarding comprehension. For the comprehension question, can we give a long sentence answer?
Long sentence answer. What does it mean?
Instead of giving the answer. I mean, it's a complete sentence, in a complete sentence.
Okay, all right. Sentence, yeah? I mean, let's say, but if the question is asking you for a word, then you should not. If the question is asking you for a phrase, then no. Okay, but if, let's say you know the answer is there and you want to lift the whole sentence and put it in your answer, yes, you can. Okay, yes, you can. But look at the question first, requirement of the question. Okay, it's not all the question you can give one sentence as the answer. Okay?
Okay, and thank you. And we have another question. I mean, two questions related to novel. Okay, one student asked, Gallery and SMC, teacher, how many paragraphs to write with the write novel? I always write in one paragraph. And Akila asked, how much points should I give when answering novel question? So I think we can combine this, right? Paragraphing and also the points.
Okay, all right. Now, usually, okay, let's say, based on the novel that you have studied, highlight the characters of the main character in the novel, all right? So let's say I'm going to talk about Richard because we are doing Dear Mr. Kilmer, Richard. Okay, so I would say I have... as a candidate, I have to show my examiner that I have read the novel. Okay, and I cannot do that in one paragraph. Okay, I need to give at least two to three points. For example, Richard is a very good brother. Then I must explain, why do I say that Richard is a very good brother? Then I say Richard is a very good friend. So two content points already. A good brother, so you give all the incidents in the novel that shows that he is a very good brother. Then very good friend. Okay, so you can divide this friend, because in Dear Mr. Kilmer, he is a good friend to another character, and he is also a very good friend to Dear Mr. Kilmer in a way. Okay, so here you can break. So if you ask me, you need to have maybe two or three points to show that you have read the novel. So one paragraph for intro, as I mentioned just now, it doesn't have to be long. Maybe two or three lines is fine. And one paragraph for conclusion. So in between, you must have at least two or three would be better. Two would be fine. Okay, so I hope that answers the question.
All right, thank you. So one of the students actually asked, his name is Killer Gaming. I think he's a gamer, because he did mention that he doesn't know how to write an introduction for novel. But don't worry, Teacher Najima just shared just now, you only need two or three sentences. You just have to mention the title of the novel that you've chosen, the author, and the character that you choose based on the question. Okay, I like these two next questions. It's related to summary, Teacher Najima.
Yeah, okay.
The first question is, how to differentiate between points and elaboration? All right. And the next one is, if, let's say, the summary asks two questions, there are two bullets, there are two tasks, do we need to arrange them? For example, do we answer the first required point first, then only we go to the second one? For example, what did Teacher Najima do with her students? And bullet number two, how did the students show their appreciation to Teacher Najima? So sometimes in the text, they are like in between, right? So should they compile all the first points first, then only they write the second ones, or they can just in between?
Okay.
Following the flow of the text.
Okay. You see, I'm talking as a teacher lah, when I mark my student's summary, the content points will be arranged in such a way that it just follows the lines. Okay, let's say paragraph one, the content point C1, C2 is there. The C1 might be referring to bullet one. The C2 might be referring to bullet two, right? But it still follows that order, C1, C2, C3, all the way to C15, for example. So my advice would be not to separate them. Okay, just put them together in one paragraph. Because you see, when you separate, from what I understand is indirectly, you are going to have two paragraphs. Right? So you just put them together, because even when I mark, as a teacher, when I mark, my content points are not separated. They are put as one. So if I see C1 in my student's work, okay, I'll mark C1. Then C2, okay, maybe C5 is answering bullet one. But C8 will be C6 will be answering bullet two. So it doesn't matter. So just put them together as one paragraph, and it'll be easier for the examiner to mark. Okay.
Okay. What if, let's say, these students have good proficiency in English, and they want to still separate those two bullets so that the flow of the summary, it flows smoothly. For example, first, they want to explain about how you sacrifice for the kids, all right? And then maybe when they want to go to the second bullet, after all the sacrifice made by Teacher Najima, all the students show their appreciation by pop, 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 pop. They mention all the... Is that okay?
Yeah.
That is still accepted. Okay.
Yeah. If a candidate is a very good candidate and they want that flow, okay, yes, they can. But if... we just want to write out a summary, we may want to make sure there's 10 content points, then just following through, just basing it on what you read and just transferring it would be fine.
What about students, those with challenges, you know, sometimes when they follow the content point, the sentence doesn't really make sense, you know, from one point to another.
There's no cohesive and cohesion.
Okay.
For example, point one is not, when they mention about point two, it's not connected. I mean, it doesn't stand together. You know what I mean?
Okay.
When you read the sentence, you know it doesn't make sense. But the content point is there. The keywords are there. Uh-huh. You see that the sentence doesn't make sense.
Okay. One of the things that I teach my weak students is, you choose your 10 content points, and then each content point you make one sentence. Right, so or you combine, or could you combine with them, all right? So,
the combination part, the combining part is very tricky because some students they don't get it. Like maybe they want to combine C4 and C5, but then again, those are two different points. Instead of and, they're supposed to use but, you know,
that is how you see, those are the things that you can only improve in practice. Okay, when you do a lot of practice, then you will know, okay, this content point, there are content points that I can use and, but not all content points I can use and. Sometimes I because this idea and this idea are contrasting ideas, I need to use but. Okay, but all this can only come with practice. So my advice would be, go back to your teacher, you know, do more summary. And I'm sure summary is very easy to score, as long as you don't think too much and complicate the summary. Yep. Okay, so the basic, do it as it is. I think you'll be fine. If we want, if you may not be able to get 15 over 15, but I always believe 13 over 15 is in your hands.
Okay. Let's have the final question from Nur Fatin. It's related to novel. Teacher, can I write a short conclusion for the novel?
Yes.
The concluding paragraph?
Yes.
How simple can it be? How short can it be?
Okay, from what I tell my weaker students would be, just have like, based on all my elaborations and examples that I've given above, it is very clear why I feel Richard is one of the most kind character in this story. That would only be one or two lines maybe, okay, but still there is a conclusion, all right? Because you must understand, for this particular section novel, for novel, we are not so much into we are not so much into making sure there is a long paragraph of intro, there's a long paragraph of conclusion. No, we just want to make sure you answer the question. You give us evidence, you give us example to show that you have read the novel.
Thank you so much, Teacher Najima. Okay. Any last words from you, Teacher Najima, for our 2020 candidates?
Okay. I know it's tough. I understand, okay? It's not easy for you to be preparing for your SPM in the current situation, but take it as a challenge, all right, and tell yourself that I can do it. Okay, everybody can help you to do it, but you have to believe that you can do it. So we are trying to give you the support, we are trying to help you, but you must tell yourself, I will do it. All right, all the best and good luck. May Allah help all of us, may Allah guide all of us, and may all of us be healthy. And semoga all of you, okay, all of you out there, you will do well, you will excel, and inshallah, we want to see all the candidates who participate in our 2 days program do well in SPM. Thank you, everyone. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. Thank you.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh. So thank you, everyone. We have like 112 students watching our session today. Thank you so much. I believe all of them, you have benefited a lot from Teacher Najima's session. And we're going to take 15 minutes break, and you are going to be with Teacher Ayu, Cikgu Ayu, for BM session. Thank you so much, Teacher Najima. Have a good weekend and take care, everyone. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Dah jam. Okay, I'm going to do that.
Jadi
dapat pulang lagi Okay, soalan nombor 2 yang popular.
Negatif 3 dan negatif 3 kuasa 2. So, kita dapat apa? Negatif? Negatif 3 kuasa 2.
Okay, jadi sama-sama kita tumpukan perhatian kepada teori kinetik ciri. Okay?
Dan agak percaya di kita pun ada ajaran yang
praktis. Kami kena ingat, dia diberi gelaran penyelamat umat Islam. Ingat yang itu.
Perbandingan berkaitan performance. Yang panjang Maharaja
Leda. Dia ni memang dia pergi kat tengah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh everyone and welcome to Mahir Teacher.
Pernahkah anda terfikir untuk belajar skill baru tapi tak tahu nak cari kat mana? Bayaran mahal. Bila jumpa yang sesuai, alahai, tempat kursus jauhnya. Memperkenalkan planetmahir.com. Planet Mahir adalah platform pembelajaran online dalam bahasa Melayu yang pertama di dunia. Ianya murah dan senang nak akses. Melalui Planet Mahir, anda boleh belajar pelbagai skill yang anda mahu. Anda boleh memilih dari ratusan skill daripada instruktor-instruktor yang berpengalaman dan tersohor. Nak belajar cara buat mobile app hebat? Menyanyi macam Siti Nurhaliza? Nak berniaga tapi tak tahu mula macam mana? Usah risau. Di Planet Mahir, kami menyediakan kursus-kursus yang anda boleh pilih satu-satu atau terus bandelkan semua kursus yang anda mahu. Ataupun anda nak buat duit mengajar orang lain. Senang saja. Cuma create account anda, muat naik video dan bahan pembelajaran dan pilih berapa harga anda nak jual. Di Planet Mahir, anda boleh belajar apa sahaja, mengajar apa sahaja. Anytime, anywhere. Start learning, start earning.
Bagi calon SPM, kelemahan yang biasa cikgu lihat pada mereka adalah mereka tidak menguasai soalan yang diberikan, tidak menjawab mengikut kehendak soalan, bilangan patah perkataan tidak mencukupi, seterusnya tidak dapat mengembangkan isi karangan. Nama saya Nur Hafizah binti Muhammad atau lebih dikenali sebagai Cikgu Ayu. Cikgu merupakan graduan daripada Universiti Malaya dalam pengajian Islam. Cikgu mempunyai pengalaman lebih daripada 12 tahun dalam bidang pendidikan. Cikgu memulakan mengajar dalam subjek pendidikan Islam, seterusnya beralih ke mata pelajaran Bahasa Melayu. Satu cerita yang boleh cikgu kongsikan, seorang pelajar dia tidak lulus pada awalnya dalam subjek Bahasa Melayu. Kemudian cikgu telah melihat bagaimana kepayahan dan kesusahannya untuk menguasai Bahasa Melayu. Seterusnya cikgu telah berkongsi tips dan teknik kepada dia dan akhirnya dia telah mendapat keputusan yang cemerlang dalam Bahasa Melayu iaitu A+. Dan untuk pengetahuan kamu, pelajar itu berbangsa Cina. Melalui kelas ini, cikgu akan kongsikan bagaimana cara untuk menjawab soalan mengikut skema yang dikendaki. Selain itu, cikgu juga akan mengajar teknik untuk menghasilkan karangan yang cemerlang. Saya Cikgu Ayu, guru Bahasa Melayu anda. Temui saya di Mahir Tutor.
Salah satu kelemahan pelajar kita tentang subjek kimia, mereka pada asalnya sudah takut untuk menghadapi subjek kimia itu sendiri. Kimia datang daripada perkataan Arab al-kimia, bermaksud perkara yang berubah-ubah. Apa yang berubah-ubah? Iaitu jirim. Jadi di dalam subjek kimia kita akan mengkaji kesan jirim, komposisi jirim dan bagaimana jirim berinteraksi antara satu sama yang lain. Hello guys, assalamualaikum. Nama saya Muhammad Hazri dan saya berasal dari Pulau Pinang. Saya merupakan graduan Bioprocess Engineering di UNIMEM dan kemudian saya menyambung pelajaran saya dalam kejuruteraan kimia di USM. Pengalaman mengajar saya, saya merupakan bekas guru di MRSM, di 4 buah MRSM, MRSM Kuala Kelawang, MRSM Kubang Pasu, MRSM Pekalan Hulu dan MRSM Langkawi. Dan sekarang saya bertugas di salah sebuah sekolah international di Cyberjaya. Sedulu ada seorang pelajar yang pada asalnya pada tingkatan 4 dia sangat lemah dalam konsep kimia. Jadi apabila dia sangat lemah dalam konsep kimia, dia berasa rendah diri. Apa yang perlu dibuat adalah seorang guru tu perlu memainkan peranan untuk menaikkan semangat pelajar itu sendiri. Dan seterusnya, alhamdulillah pelajar itu tersebut berjaya mendapat E di dalam SPM-nya. Teknik yang saya akan guna di dalam tempoh pembelajaran kita adalah dengan mengaitkan fakta kimia dengan kehidupan seharian kita. Contohnya, kita mengkaji tentang teori kinetik. Jadi, saya akan cuba kaitkan dengan kehidupan seharian kita dengan membancuh air gula di dalam air masak. Jadi, dengan menggunakan konsep yang ada di kehidupan seharian kita, anda berjaya dapat memahami konsep kimia itu sendiri. Ikuti saya, Sir Hazri, untuk subjek kimia di Mahir Tutor.
Dalam kehidupan harian kita pun, kita perlukan matematik. Contohnya seperti naik bas, kira duit. So, semua ni memerlukan asas-asas matematik. So, bayangkan kalau kita tidak tahu matematik, macam mana kita nak teruskan kehidupan selepas pembelajaran kita? Masalah pelajar sekarang ni, dia adalah lemah konsep matematik di peringkat sekolah rendah dan juga di peringkat PT3. Ini adalah masalah biasa bagi pelajar SPM. Saya lebih dikenali dengan Cikgu Azman. So, saya mempunyai pengalaman hampir 12 tahun. Pakaran saya adalah dalam bidang matematik di mana saya banyak mengajar matematik sekolah rendah dan juga sekolah menengah. Saya jurusan daripada Sains Gunaan UiTM Shah Alam di mana sebelum ini saya mempunyai pengalaman dalam bidang automotif di mana berkecimpung banyak dalam industri automotif, pembuatan kereta dan kenderaan. Selepas beberapa tahun, minat saya mendalam dalam mendidik anak-anak. Maka saya telah move dan bergerak ke arah pendidikan di mana saya telah berhenti dalam industri saya dan masuk dalam industri pendidikan. Bayangkan bahawa kita mempunyai 2 bulan sahaja exam dan pelajar ini fail semasa trial dia. Dia jumpa dengan saya, so saya bagi beberapa nasihat, beberapa tip untuk mereka terus fokus dan membuat beberapa strategi. So daripada gagal, mereka terus mendapat A. Mengejutkan kan? tapi itulah hakikatnya. Saya, Cikgu Mama Azman Mahmat Nur, mengajar subjek matematik. Temui saya dalam Mahir Tutor.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh dan salam sejahtera. Baik, kita akan sambung sesi seminar SPM 2020 kita secara online yang dibawakan oleh Mahir Tutor. Dan tadi baru selesai seminar bahasa Inggeris dan kita akan sambung. Baik-baik adik-adik, apa khabar? Bagaimana hari ini? Sihat? Dan dengan sesi pada kali ini, cikgu harap kamu dah berada dalam keadaan yang selesa, bersedia dan pastikan ada pen, ada buku nota yang kamu boleh catat apa yang akan dibentangkan oleh penceramah nanti. Dan sekiranya terdapat soalan atau kamu mempunyai soalan, jangan lupa tinggalkan soalan tersebut di ruangan chat. Okay? Dan untuk makluman semua, Mahir Tutor kini telah mencecah 10,000 pelajar di seluruh Malaysia. Okay, di mana kamu semua boleh mengakses bahan pengajaran iaitu 10 subjek SPM melalui website kami di planetmahir.com/tutor. Okay, dan laman sesawang ni kamu boleh akses di mana-mana pada bila-bila masa. Dan kamu juga boleh mengikuti pengajaran setiap silibus sama ada tingkatan 4 atau tingkatan 5 untuk membuat ulang kaji sebelum menduduki SPM pada bulan depan. Okey, dan semua pengajaran tersebut telah direkodkan. Okey, dan kamu boleh menontonnya secara video on demand. Okey, bagi yang belum mendaftar, boleh PM sama ada dekat Facebook Planet Mahir ataupun Instagram Mahir Tutor. Dan bagi yang tak tahu, cikgu merupakan tutor untuk bahasa Melayu. Baik, untuk tak nak membuang masa, untuk sesi kali ini, kita akan diajar trik dan teknik-teknik yang kamu boleh gunakan untuk menjawab soalan subjek bagi bahasa Melayu. Dan untuk sesi kali ini, Cikgu Siti Noraina binti Ahmad akan membentangkan untuk kertas bahasa Melayu, yang mana beliau merupakan guru bahasa Melayu di Sekolah Menengah Kebangsaan Lelaki Bukit Bintang. Okey. Cikgu Aina pun dah ada. Hai Cikgu Aina.
Hai. Hai Cikgu Ayu.
Hai Ko. Merupakan mempunyai pengalaman mengajar selama 7 tahun ya. Dan merupakan tamu DBP. Betul ya? Dewan Bahasa dan Pustaka.
Dewan Bahasa dan Pustaka. Baik.
Okey. Tanpa buang masa, saya persilakan Cikgu Siti Noraina untuk meneruskan sesi pagi ini.
Baik. Terima kasih Cikgu Ayu. Assalamualaikum dan selamat pagi kepada semua. Selamat berkenalan dan salam 29 hari lagi menuju SPM. Okey. Baik. Pada hari ini, sebelum Cikgu mulakan perkongsian, sebab Cikgu nak kongsi sedikit sebanyaklah tentang kertas satu. Jadi sebelum Cikgu mulakan, Cikgu harap semua orang boleh berdoa lah kot sikit, minta semoga Tuhan buka hati dan lapangkan hati kita untuk menerima ilmu. Bukan setakat awak saja menerima ilmu, cikgu juga akan belajar ilmu yang baharu. Baik. Semoga perkongsian ini dapat membantu kamu semua untuk menjawab soalan kertas satu nanti. Tapi cikgu tidaklah akan mengajar kamu macam mana nak menulis karangan, sebab kalau nak mengajar menulis karangan, kita perlukan masa, perlukan buat bengkel. Jadi apa yang cikgu kongsikan adalah panduan, tips dan juga bagaimana untuk memastikan karangan yang kamu tulis nanti boleh mencapai tahap cemerlang. Okey, baiklah cikgu akan kongsi bahan sekarang. Sekejap ya. Maaf sekejap. Okey, boleh nampak skrin cikgu? Boleh nampak skrin cikgu? Sekejap ya. Baik, untuk kertas satu bahasa Melayu ni, awak kena, yang pertama sekali kena kenal pasti. Kertas satu bahasa Melayu. Kertas satu bahasa Melayu, kodnya ialah 1103-1. Awak kena kenal pasti betul-betul kod kertas ini, iaitu 1103-1. Kenapa cikgu tekankan di sini? Kerana semasa menjawab SPM nanti, ada calon yang sebenarnya salah menulis kod kertas. Dia tulis kod kertas lain, bukan 1103-1. Jadi awak kena berhati-hati dan kena betul-betul pastikan ini adalah kod untuk bahasa Melayu. Baik. Untuk target bahasa Melayu awak, awak nak A+, nak A atau nak A-? A+ pun boleh dapat, A pun boleh dapat, A- pun boleh dapat. Ketiga-tiga ini bergantung kepada usaha awak sendiri. Dan macam mana awak nak nak capai? Awak nak capai A+, awak nak capai A atau awak nak capai A-? Tapi cikgu doakan semua yang mendengar pada hari ini akan dapat keputusan yang paling cemerlang lah A+, okey? Baik. Seterusnya, garis panduan mata pelajaran SPM keperluan kertas satu. Kertas satu Kita dah tahu, semua orang sedia maklum yang kertas satu ni ialah kertas karangan. Bila kertas karangan, apa yang perlu ditulis adalah apa yang perlu awak lakukan ialah menulis. Kertas satu karangan ni selalunya kertas yang paling tidak disukai oleh murid-murid. Tambah-tambah lagi murid lelaki. Macam cikgu, cikgu mengajar murid-murid lelaki, mereka sangatlah mengelak untuk menulis karangan. Tetapi untuk pengetahuan awak semua, kertas satu yang membawa peratus paling banyak untuk markah SPM, iaitu sebanyak 60%, sebab markahnya ialah 130. Markah penuh ialah 130, dan bila percentage dia akan jadi 60%. Jadi bentuk soalan jenis item ni adalah item berbentuk subjektif. Soalan karangan memang berbentuk subjektif. Awak kena tulis. Bila soalan subjektif sebenarnya lebih mudah sebab awak boleh menulis apa sahaja yang awak nak tulis. Dan kertas satu ni ada dua bahagian. Bahagian A, karangan rangsangan, dan juga bahagian B, karangan umum ataupun respon terbuka. Karangan bahagian A ni, karangan rangsangan, kita juga panggil sebagai karangan respon terhad. Sebab kenapa kita panggil respon terhad? Sebab isi telah pun diberi, panduan untuk menulis tu sudah ada. Jadi sebab itulah panggil respon terhad. Dan karangan berharansangan, sebab bahan ada, kita tulis berdasarkan bahan. Tetapi karangan bahagian B, karangan umum, dia lebih terbuka dan boleh melahirkan orang-orang yang lebih kreatif. Awak pun boleh menulis apa sahaja yang awak nak tulis selagi bertepatan dengan soalan dan juga relevan. Okay, dan tempoh ujian untuk jawab kertas satu ialah selama 2 jam 15 minit. 2 jam 15 minit ni memang dengar lama. Lamanya cikgu, 2 jam 15 minit memang lama. Tapi bila awak start, awak mula saja pegang pen, awak takkan rasa lama pun. Nanti mungkin masa tak cukup lagi nak habiskan karangan awak tu. Okey, baik. Kita bergerak kepada slide seterusnya. Okey, berapa soalan yang perlu dijawab? Okey, karangan, kalau bahagian A wajib jawab. Satu soalan saja wajib jawab, 30 markah. Awak tak nak jawab pun awak kena jawab. Awak nak jawab pun sangatlah lagi menggembirakan. Sebab 30 markah ni sebenarnya untuk bahagian A ni untuk membantu awak. 30 markah tu awak boleh dapat. Sebenarnya awak boleh dapat. Awak boleh dapat paling tinggi 29/30. Sebab setakat ni tak ada lagi lah orang yang memang betul-betul sempurna karangannya dapat sampai 30 markah. Adalah kesilapan sedikit di sana sini. Tetapi ada orang dapat 29 markah per 30, dan lembaga peperiksaan benarkan dia dapat 29/30. Sebab itulah karangan bahagian A ni sebenarnya sangat membantu awak untuk menaikkan markah bahagian karangan. Dan karangan bahagian B pula 100 markah, diberi 5 soalan dan jawab satu saja. Jawab satu sahaja, tak perlu jawab banyak-banyak, jawab satu soalan sahaja. Okay? Baik, format soalan. Untuk karangan bahagian A, karangan berpandu atau karangan berharansangan, masa menjawab yang dicadangkan ialah 45 minit. Cadangan sahaja ya, sebab bila kita kira dengan patah perkataan, iaitu panjang karangan ni antara 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan, 45 minit tu sangat memadai untuk menjawab satu karangan bahagian A, sebab patah perkataannya sedikit, 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan. Okey. Sementara cikgu ingat ni, cikgu cakap siap-siap. Bila patah perkataan ni ialah 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan sahaja, adakah dibenarkan tulis kurang atau lebih? Tulis kurang boleh, tulis lebih pun boleh. Tulis kurang, kalau awak tulis kurang daripada 200 patah perkataan, maksudnya markah awak kurang lah. Kalau awak tulis lebih daripada 250 patah perkataan, bukanlah bermaksud markah awak akan lebih. Tak, 30 tetap 30. Tetapi markah tidak akan ditolak. Dan untuk pengetahuan awak, karangan bahagian A, patah perkataan dikira satu persatu. Cukup tak 250? Kita nak tengok betul tak calon tulis sampai 250. Cukup tak 250 tu? Sebab kita nak bagi markah berdasarkan apa yang ditulis. Dan karangan, penilaian terhadap karangan adalah secara holistik, iaitu secara menyeluruh. Nanti bila slide yang seterusnya, awak akan nampak apa yang cikgu maksudkan sebagai karangan tu ditanda secara holistik. Okay? Okey, bentuk soalan. Bentuk soalan untuk karangan bahagian rangsangan ni ada gambar, foto, gambar rajah, ilustrasi kartun, pelan, peta, iklan, petikan, catatan, dialog. Tetapi selain daripada gambar, foto dan gambar rajah, ilustrasi kartun, pelan, peta, iklan, petikan, catatan dengan dialog ni sudah lama tak keluar. sudah lama tidak disoal dalam kertas peperiksaan dan kebanyakan yang keluar adalah gambar foto dengan marajah. Tahun ni pun cikgu menjangkakan yang soalan akan keluar gambar rajah dan juga gambar rajah sama ada gambar rajah ataupun gambar foto. Sebab soalan diberi selalunya berikut ikut mengikut trend. Jadi kalau trendnya begitu, soalan yang keluar pun mungkin begitu. Dan rasa-rasanya soalan yang keluar tu berkaitan dengan sekolah. Jadi kalau boleh buat catatan, tolonglah catat sedikit. Untuk karangan bahagian rangsangan ni, skopnya adalah sekolah. Okay? Okay, ini adalah contoh soalan. Lihat rajah di bawah ini dengan teliti. Huraikan pendapat anda tentang kebaikan program di televisyen. Panjang huraian anda hendaklah antara 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan. Okay, dia memang bagi anggaran 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan. Macam cikgu cakap tadi, boleh tak tulis kurang atau lebih? Kurang tak ada masalah, markahkan kurang. Tapi kalau awak tulis lebih, setakat ini lembaga membenarkan murid menulis lebih daripada 250 patah perkataan. Tetapi janganlah sampai 250 tu awak pergi tulis sampai 500 patah perkataan. Itu dah tak relevan lah maksudnya. Kalau 250 tu sampai 260, 270 atau sampai 300 masih boleh diterima pakai. Dan awak masih layak untuk dapat cemerlang. Okey, macam mana pula kalau tiba-tiba awak tulis, cikgu saya tulis sampai 240 je, lepas tu saya dah tak tahu nak tulis apa, saya stop dekat situ. Saya berhenti je dekat 240, saya layak tak dapat cemerlang. Sekiranya isi isi yang awak huraikan tu memadai, maksud cikgu relevan, matang, awak layak juga dapat cemerlang. Okey, tengok dekat sini program televisyen banyak membawa kebaikan. Ada 4 isi, 1, 2, 3, 4. Selalunya soalan yang di soalan SPM yang keluar trend 5 tahun kebelakangan ini, isi yang diberi itu 3 sahaja. Tapi kalau diberi 4, macam mana? Nak tulis keempat-empatnya ke? Ya. Sekiranya isi diberi, kalau isi tu diberi 3 atau 4, awak kena guna kesemua isi. Sekiranya awak tidak gunakan isi tersebut, maksudnya awak guna 3 je. Tak nak yang keempat ni. Tak suka cikgu, saya tak suka, saya tak nak hurai. Biar je dia. Tak boleh. Awak kena gunakan keempat-empatnya. Sama juga kalau diberi 3 isi, awak kena huraikan ketiga-tiga isi. Tetapi, katalah diberi 3 isi, awak rasa tak cukup lah cikgu, saya nak tambah lagi 1 isi sebab patah perkataan masih belum capai 250. Boleh tak? Boleh. Dibenarkan. Awak boleh tambah isi untuk karangan bahagian rangsangan. Tambah isi awak sendiri. Tapi isi tersebut mesti menepati kehendak soalan dan juga relevan dengan kehendak soalan. Sekiranya tidak, isi itu tidak akan dikira dan impression terhadap karangan awak akan menurun. Nanti kita tengok apa yang cikgu maksudkan dengan menurun tu. Okey? Baik. Yang ini contoh yang kedua. Gambar foto. Lihat gambar di bawah dengan teliti. Huraikan pendapat anda tentang kepentingan menjaga kawasan pelancongan. Okey. Huraikan pendapat tentang kepentingan menjaga kawasan pelancongan. Okey, dia beri gambar rajah sahaja. Gambar rajah je. Tak ada maklumat, tak ada data, tak ada apa. Kosong, gambar sahaja. Apa yang kita nak hurai? Apa yang perlu kita huraikan berdasarkan gambar yang telah diberi? Okey, bila awak dapat soalan berbentuk macam ni, awak dapat soalan berbentuk diberi gambar sahaja, apa yang perlu awak buat ialah awak huraikan apa yang awak nampak daripada gambar tersebut. Tetapi mesti bertepatan dengan kehendak soalan. Okey, berbalik kepada kehendak soalan, lihat gambar di bawah dengan teliti. Huraikan pendapat anda tentang kepentingan menjaga kawasan pelancongan. Jadi, tengok gambar ni, apakah yang penting, pendapat, apakah yang penting menjaga kawasan pelancongan daripada gambar rajah ini. Okey, cikgu bagi satu contohlah kepada awak. Kepentingan menjaga kawasan pelancongan ialah untuk menarik kedatangan pelancong asing ke negara kita. Betul? Ya, betul. Sebab kita jaga kawasan pelancongan ni untuk menarik kedatangan pelancong. Tapi sekarang dengan pandemik yang melanda negara, melanda dunia, menyebabkan kita tak ada pelancong lain yang datang. Jadi adakah isi ni relevan? Boleh tak lagi? Macam sebab tiba-tiba soalan ni yang keluar tapi kita tak boleh nak tarik pelancong asing. Isi ni relevan tak? Ya, masih relevan sebab kelazimannya memang kita tarik pelancong daripada luar negara untuk datang ke negara bagi menjana ekonomi negara. Jadi awak boleh gunakan isi tu. Jangan risau, jangan rasa macam cikgu mana ada orang, mana ada pelancong asing datang pun kalau saya tulis ni salah isi saya. Tak, isi awak masih betul sebab isi mestilah selaras dengan kelaziman. Cuma sekarang ni kita mengamalkan normal baharu iaitu penjaga penjarakan, jaga 3S. Okey. Apa-apa pun awak tulislah berdasarkan apa yang cikgu cakap tadi, nampak pada gambar rajah tu, awak tulis berdasarkan apa yang awak nampak di gambar rajah tu. Jangan risau, jangan takut. Tak ada yang betul, tak ada yang salah bila tak ada fakta. Sebab diberi gambar rajah, kaitkan dengan soalan. Jadi bila awak kaitkan dengan soalan, insyaAllah jawapan awak akan betul. Okey. Okey, pemarkahan dekat. Maaf. Pemarkahan. Ini adalah pemarkahan bagi bahagian A. Okey. Ada lima aspek untuk memberikan markah. Cikgu rasa kamu semua mesti tahu, mesti ada yang pernah dapat cemerlang, mungkin ada yang pernah dapat kepujian, memuaskan, kurang memuaskan atau pencapaian minimum. Macam ni, bila awak nak dapat cemerlang, markahnya ada 26 hingga 30 markah. Sekiranya awak boleh capai 26 markah, karangan awak sangat baiklah sebenarnya, sebab karangan awak tu akan menepati tema. Tema maksudnya ialah tema tu menepati soalan yang diberi. Soalan tu beri, awak boleh jawab berdasarkan soalan dengan tepat. Itu dipanggil menepati tema. Bahasa yang awak gunakan gramatis, maksudnya semua ayat yang awak gunakan tu ada subjek dan predikat, ada pelengkap. Ayat awak tidak tergantung, ayat awak tidak tidak huru hara, gunakan perkataan kosa kata yang luas dan tepat, wacana awak lengkap. Wacana lengkap maksudnya ialah karangan awak ada perenggan pengenalan, perenggan isi dan perenggan penutup dan ada ungkapan yang menarik. Dan idea yang awak berikan relevan dan matang. Idea relevan dan matang ni pada huraian isi awak nanti. Macam kalau karangan bahagian A, kan ada karangan yang tadi cikgu kata telah ada isi kan, ada yang dah diberikan isi. Jadi bila dah diberikan isi tu, apa yang perlu awak buat ialah menghuraikan sahaja isi tersebut. Jadi bila awak huraikan isi tu, huraian awak itu mestilah relevan dan matang. Matang ni maksudnya dia selari dengan isi yang telah diberikan. Dan apabila awak dapat kepujian 20 hingga 25 markah, karangan awak masih dalam, maksudnya peluang awak untuk dapat A tu masih tinggi. Bila awak dapat kepujian, maksudnya awak punya karangan tu masih menepati tema, bahasa awak masih, bahasa awak gramatis, kosa kata awak luas, tetapi nampak tak, kosa kata luas tapi tak tepat. Dia dah kurang satu. Kosa kata luas tapi tak tepat. Mungkin penggunaan perkataan awak itu tidak bertepatan dengan kehendak soalan atau tidak bertepatan dengan huraian yang awak beri. Wacana awak lengkap, idea relevan dan jelas. Dan selepas kepujian, memuaskan. Kalau awak dapat markah antara 15 hingga 19, awak kena risau sedikit sebab ini adalah potensi untuk turun grade daripada A kepada B. Okey, bila awak dapat memuaskan, masih menepati tema, bahasa masih gramatis, kosa kata terhad, wacana masih lengkap, maksudnya masih karangan dia masih ada pengenalan, masih ada isi dan masih ada penutup, idea masih relevan dan huraian idea masih jelas. Huraian idea tu masih jelas, maksudnya awak boleh menghuraikan idea dengan jelas. Cuma mungkin huraian awak tu tak mencukupi untuk dapat cemerlang. Dan yang seterusnya ialah kurang memuaskan, 10 hingga 14 markah. Kurang menepati tema. Maksudnya karangan awak sendiri pun isi tu pun dah tak tepat dengan tema. Bahasa kurang gramatis, bahasa dah start huru hara. Kami panggil bahasa huru hara ni maksudnya macam bahasa awak tu dah tata bahasa dah ada banyak kesalahan. Untuk ke di semua tu dah tak betul penggunaannya, kosa kata terhad, idea kurang relevan dan huraian kurang jelas. Huraian kurang jelas ni maksudnya hurai tapi tak bertepatan dengan isi. Hurai ya hurai, awak boleh menghurai tapi kalau isi tentang kesihatan tiba-tiba awak hurai tentang keselamatan. Tu tak tepat lah, maksudnya dia memang tak relevan lah. Dan pencapaian minimum. Pencapaian minimum ni sebenarnya untuk calon yang dia tak boleh menulis. Dia tak boleh menulis, dia tak boleh membaca. Dia memang akan dapat pencapaian minimum. Banyak kesalahan bahasa dari segi kata dan ayat. Idea tidak menepati tema, berharan sangan. Dia jawab karangan tapi tak tahu dia tulis apa. Ada, memang ada macam tu. Jadi cikgu doakan semoga yang mendengar pada hari ini boleh dapat cemerlang, boleh dapat kepujian. Okay. Baik, yang seterusnya, karangan berpandu yang cemerlang mestilah memenuhi syarat-syarat yang berikut. Memenuhi dan menepati kehendak arahan soalan. Tadi cikgu dah kata mesti patuh, tepat dan menepati, menepati kehendak arahan soalan. Maksudnya soalan nak apa, awak jawab berdasarkan apa yang soalan nak. Jangan soalan nak kesihatan, awak beri keselamatan. Tu dah terpesong. Bila terpesong, dia sebenarnya takkan potong markah awak. Tetapi dia akan turunkan rank daripada cemerlang terus turun ke pujian. Walaupun bahasa awak cantik macam mana pun, tetapi kalau awak terpesong sedikit, dia terus turun daripada cemerlang kepada kepujian. Lepas tu bila baca lagi karangan, jumpa lagi banyak kesalahan tata bahasa, kesalahan ejaan, kesalahan huraian lagi, terus lagi turun kepada memuaskan. Itulah yang dipanggil penandaan secara holistik. Kita akan baca secara keseluruhan, lepas tu barulah kita berikan markah. Yang keduanya, kembali kepada keperluan karangan berpandu yang memenuhi syarat tu. Macam mana nak dapat cemerlang. Yang kedua, mempunyai isi-isi penting yang cukup. Yang seterusnya, mempunyai idea yang tersusun, iaitu isi penting didahulukan dan isi yang kurang penting dikemudiankan. Isi yang penting didahulukan, isi yang kurang penting dikemudiankan. Okey, kat sini cikgu nak jelaskan sedikit. Sekiranya awak nanti dapat soalan, soalan tu berikan isi, awak tak tahu mana awak nak letak. Mana awak nak letak dulu sebagai isi yang pertama, isi yang kedua. Itu tak ada masalah. Awak boleh letak je mana-mana isi antara, kalau dia beri tiga, tiga tu awak nak letak yang mana dulu, yang pertama, tak ada masalah. Itu tak ada masalah. Sebab ketiga-tiga isi yang diberi tu adalah isi penting. Jadi awak gunakan sahaja kesemuanya. Mempunyai perenggan yang padu dengan isi, huraian serta contoh yang sesuai. Menggunakan kosa kata mengikut laras bahasa yang betul. Menggunakan ejaan dan tanda baca yang betul. Okey, ejaan dan tanda baca yang betul ni sebenarnya, kalau awak banyak kesalahan ejaan dan banyak kesalahan tanda baca, nanti kan ada banyak skrip awak tu, skrip jawapan awak akan banyak dengan pen merah tau. Bila banyak dengan pen merah, pemeriksa tengok cakap banyaknya kesalahan. Jadi impression dia untuk memberikan markah kepada awak akan turun. Daripada awak boleh dapat cemerlang, terus awak dapat kepujian. Daripada awak boleh dapat kepujian, terus awak dapat memuaskan. Itu maksudnya. Okey. Jadi apa proses untuk menulis karangan bahagian A supaya boleh dapat markah yang cemerlang? Okey. Yang pertama, sebelum menulis, awak perlu membaca dan memahami arahan soalan serta mengenal pasti kehendak soalan. Kenal pasti kehendak soalan. Soalan nak apa? Soalan nak saya tulis karangan. Saya nak tulis apa? Itu awak kena tahu dahulu. Awak kena tahu apa yang soalan nak awak tulis. Awak tulis tak berdasarkan apa yang soalan nak. Teliti tajuk yang diberi bersama-sama dengan baharan sangan dan kaitkan dengan kehendak soalan. Perlu menangkap mesej utama daripada baharan sangan dan skop karangan yang perlu ditulis. Maksudnya kalau setakat ni tak ada lagi karangan yang cikgu jumpa, karangan bahan rangsangan bahagian A tu yang berformat, so, tak ada lagi. Berformat semua memang pergi kepada bahagian B. Okay, jadi awak boleh tulis karangan bahagian A dengan baik, cikgu yakin. Baik. Analisis baharan sangan, perlu analisis dia secara kritis dan analitik. Kenapa kritis dan analitik? Sebab awak nak memberikan huraian kepada idea yang telah diberi. Idea telah diberi, awak nak hurai je idea tu. Tapi kalau awak tak kritis, awak tak kreatif, macam mana awak nak huraikan? Jadi kat sini cadangan je lah, cadangan cikgu. Kalau awak tiba-tiba orang kata blur, tak tahu macam mana nak hurai, gunakan kaedah 4W1H, okey? Akan membantu awak untuk menghurai. Okey, tujuan kenapa awak kena analisis supaya karangan awak tak terpesong lah. Sayang kalau terpesong karangan bahagian A, sebab karangan bahagian A lah yang memberikan awak markah dan menaikkan level markah awak nanti bila dicampur dengan karangan bahagian B. Sebab karangan umum markahnya lebih mudah untuk ditolak. Maksudnya pemberian markah tu lebih mudah untuk daripada cemerlang terus turun ke pujian daripada berbanding dengan karangan bahagian A. Sebab karangan bahagian A ni, kita kita dah tahu ada isi, jadi pemeriksa pun nak memberikan markah pun dia akan beri berdasarkan apa yang awak tulis, okey. Jadi karangan bahan rangsangan ni perlu, wajib pendahuluan. Semua karangan wajib ada pendahuluan, wajib ada penutup. Kalau ada pendahuluan, ada penutup, mestilah ada isi. Cikgu selalu cakap dekat anak murid cikgu, pendahuluan tu wajib macam awak pakai baju datang sekolah, penutup tu wajib macam awak pakai seluar datang sekolah. Awak bayangkan karangan-karangan awak tak ada seluar, awak datang sekolah pakai baju saja. Tak ke pelik? Pelik kan? Jadi pendahuluan dengan penutup tu perlu. Itu pun masih ada murid cikgu yang pendahuluan ada, penutup tak ada. Memang datang sekolah pakai baju je lah dia. Jadi untuk pendahuluan ni, ayat yang berkaitan dengan tajuk dan bahan rangsangan secara am. Maksudnya awak tulis secara kaitkan dengan tajuk. Pendahuluan awak tu mesti awak kaitkan dengan tajuk. Isi penting ialah isi yang terdapat dalam bahan rangsangan dan ditambah dengan pengetahuan sedia ada calon. Mengembangkan isi. Maksudnya awak menghuraikan isi itulah, kembangkan dan penutup. Berilah pandangan, cadangan dan juga kesimpulan. Baik. Untuk menulis karangan. Penggunaan bahasa awak mesti untuk karangan bahagian A je. Penggunaan bahasa ringkas diterima. Bukan ringkas tu maksudnya perkataan YG tu, YANG tu awak eja YG, bukan. Ringkas ni maksudnya ayat awak tu ringkas. Diterima sebab karangan bahagian A patah perkataannya limit 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan saja. Jadi ringkas, tepat dan padat. Kesinambungan isi perlu diberi perhatian supaya karangan lancar. Kesinambungan isi, macam mana awak nak sambungkan isi antara satu sama lain, gunakan penanda wacana. Contoh penanda wacana dekat sini cikgu bagi sikit lah. Cikgu rasa kamu semua pun tahu penanda wacana tu macam mana nak guna dan penanda wacana apa. Kat sini cikgu bagi dalam pada itu, sehubungan dengan itu, selain itu, seterusnya di samping itu, sungguh pun demikian dan sebagainya. Baik, analisis bahan rangsangan ni, menyemak karangan. Semak semula setelah selesai menulis. Beri perhatian kepada ejaan, tanda baca dan struktur ayat. Struktur ayat, cikgu tertinggal perkataan ayat. Okey. Sebenarnya ejaan tu memanglah kita tak tolak markah. Kita tak ada macam, katalah awak banyak salah ejaan. Dua kesalahan tolak satu markah, tak ada. Sebab penandaan karangan ni adalah secara holistik sekarang ni, secara keseluruhan berdasarkan impression pembaca. Sebab tu cikgu kata elakkan kesalahan ejaan dan tanda baca supaya kurang tanda merah dalam karangan awak. Jadi bila kurang tanda merah tu, pemeriksa akan tahu yang karangan awak tu layak dapat cemerlang. Ayat agar tak ada kesalahan yang disengajakan, jumlah kata dalam lingkungan yang telah ditetapkan. Maksudnya dalam 200 hingga 250 tu mungkin 200 hingga awak lajak sikit sampai 300, boleh lagi. Catat jumlah perkataan pada baris akhir karangan, bilang patah perkataan. Awak bilang patah perkataan tu. Tapi tak payahlah awak bilang satu-satu. Awak agaklah, maksudnya satu baris tu awak bilang ada 10. Awak darab dengan berapa baris karangan awak. 10 darab dengan 5, 50 macam tu. Kalau awak kira satu-satu nanti buang masa. Tapi dekat bawah sebelah kanan kena tulis patah perkataan. Pada karangan ini, karangan bahagian A ni dan karangan bahagian B pun akan dibaca daripada huruf yang pertama awak tulis sampai titik yang terakhir. Jadi bilang patah perkataan, tulis dekat sebelah kanan. Pemeriksa akan baca. Pemeriksa akan kira karangan awak tu. Okay. Baik, peringatan mesra. Karangan yang lengkap dengan semua isi penting tetapi susunan yang tidak teratur hingga menyebabkan gaya dan pengolahan kurang lancar akan menyebabkan markah tidak dapat diberi pada peringkat cemerlang kerana cacat dari aspek persembahan dan kelancaran karangan. Itulah cikgu kata tadi. Karangan yang pertama mesti ada pengenalan isi dan juga penutup. Jadi, bila awak tulis, hati-hati dan uraikan isi sebaik-baiknya. Okey, supaya karangan awak tu boleh dapat cemerlang. Baiklah, ini adalah contoh isu yang mungkin disoal semasa peperiksaan nanti. Pencemaran alam sekitar, pembuangan bayi, penderaan kanak-kanak, kemalangan jalan raya, keruntuhan institusi keluarga, mengadasi penyakit berjangkit, masalah disiplin pelajar, masalah sosial remaja, kegiatan kurikulum, keburukan telefon bimbit, internet kepada pelajar, dan sekarang ni dah bertambah lagi satu iaitu isu pandemik yang melanda negara kita. Okey, kita pergi kepada karangan bahagian B. Karangan bahagian B iaitu karangan umum dan respon terbuka. Kenapa dia dipanggil respon terbuka? Sebab tak ada panduan. awak tulislah apa pun yang awak nak tulis. Tapi mestilah berdasarkan kepada soalan. Baik, karangan, bentuk karangan ni umum dan juga berformat. Umum ni maksudnya karangan yang tak ada format. Karangan pendapat, karangan pendapat, cerika, peribahasa, tu tak ada format. Tapi karangan berformat pun ada. Okey. Sebentar. Cikgu nak ingatkan. Okey. Apa akan berlaku sekiranya awak salah format? Adakah markah akan ditolak? Inclusion akan jatuh? Ya, kalau awak salah format, kalau karangan awak cemerlang, awak tak boleh dapat cemerlang tinggi. Awak akan dapat cemerlang sederhana. Cemerlang ada tiga, cemerlang tinggi, cemerlang sederhana dan cemerlang bawah. Okey. Cemerlang atas dan cemerlang bawah. Ya. Betul. Nanti kita tengok dekat slide yang seterusnya. Okey. Pembahagian soalan. Okey, pembahagian soalan ni awak perasan kan kalau untuk bahagian karangan bahagian B ada 5 soalan. Ada 5 soalan yang ditanya, soalan 1, soalan 2, soalan 3, soalan 4, soalan 5 kan. Setiap soalan sebenarnya mewakili 5 dimensi yang berbeza. Soalan yang pertama, dia mesti dimensi diri, individu dan remaja. Setakat ni, setakat cikgu daripada cikgu ambil peperiksa SPM, dimensi ni masih sama, tak pernah berubah. Yang kedua, dimensi keluarga. Yang ketiga, dimensi masyarakat, kerajaan, negara. Yang keempat, dimensi serantau, global, antarabangsa. Sebab tu soalan yang keempat ni selalunya berkaitan dengan luar negara, dengan negara. Okey, sekejap lagi cikgu buat penerangan sedikit. Yang kelima, dimensi komsas. Okey, dimensi yang selalu menjadi pilihan calon menjawab soalan ialah soalan satu dan soalan dua. Sebab soalan satu dengan soalan dua senang. Berkaitan dengan diri sendiri, berkaitan dengan keluarga kita. Dan kebanyakan soalan yang keluar pun memang soalan satu dan soalan dua yang senang. Kenapa soalan satu dan soalan dua senang? Sebab soalan satu dengan soalan dua ni memang untuk membantu calon menjawab supaya boleh dapat markah yang cemerlang. Okey. Soalan yang ketiga, soalan dimensi dimensi masyarakat, kerajaan dan negara ni melibatkan negara kita tau, bukan negara luar. Ni negara kita sahaja. Mungkin isu yang disoal contohnya isu pertanian, isu ekonomi, tu maksudnya dimensi masyarakat, kerajaan dan negara. Dan soalan yang keempat, soalan dimensi serantau, global, antarabangsa ni soalan luar negara. Bila awak menjawab, kalau awak pilih soalan nombor empat, awak memang kena punya ilmu pengetahuan yang cukup. Kalau tidak, awak tak boleh menulis. Sebab soalan ini, awak tak boleh menipu fakta tau. Kalau awak menipu, contohlah fakta tu tak ada pun, tiba-tiba awak tulis sendiri. Pemeriksa akan Google, akan check fakta awak tu betul ataupun tidak. Sebab ini ialah soalan dimensi. Dia soalan global. Soalan melibatkan antarabangsa. Dan kalau contoh tiba-tiba awak jawab soalan ni sebab soalan ni senang, tiba-tiba awak bagi contoh tu contoh dalam negara sahaja, salah. Karangan awak akan terus jatuh. Walaupun cemerlang, dia tak akan turun kepada kepujian, dia terus turun kepada memuaskan. Markah awak akan tinggal 60 lebih sahaja. Jadi berhati-hati pilih soalan. Dan soalan yang kelima, soalan dimensi komsas. Soalan dimensi komsas ni, komsas lah, dia memang pasal mengenai laras sastra, semua laras sastra. Jadi kalau awak tak mahir sastra, jangan jawab. Cikgu tak cadangkan betul. Cikgu tak cadangkan pun untuk awak jawab soalan 4 dan soalan 5. Okey. Kecuali kalau awak ambil sastra, awak memang mahir, awak nak jawab, jawablah. Kat situ lubuk markah awak. Okey. Ini ulangan saja. 5 soalan dikemukakan dan pilih satu soalan panjang. Panjang karangan. Perlu melebihi 350 patah perkataan. Perlu melebihi. Maksudnya kalau tak melebih, apa akan berlaku? Boleh dapat cemerlang tak? Kalau tak lebih daripada 350 patah perkataan tapi dah nak sampai sikit lagi, ujung-ujung corner dah 340, masih layak dapat cemerlang. Tapi kalau kurang daripada tu, 330, 320, awak tak boleh dapat cemerlang. Awak mesti tulis lebih daripada 350 patah perkataan. Awak nak cemerlang kan? Jadi tulislah lebih daripada 350 patah perkataan. Masa yang dicadangkan 1 jam 30 minit ni 100 markah. 100 markah, 350 patah perkataan, 1 jam 30 minit sangat memadai. Awak boleh kuasai ketiga-tiga ini dan kena kuasai. Masa masih ada, buatlah latihan. Kalaupun awak menulis karangan tu bukan untuk cikgu awak tak sempat nak semak, awak tulislah sebagai latihan kepada diri sendiri. Nanti bila awak dah dalam dewan peperiksaan, awak tak ada masalah. Okay. Ini adalah kriteria dan deskripsi pemarkahan untuk bahagian B, sama juga sebenarnya, bahasa, laras, idea, pengolahan, gaya bahasa. Tapi untuk karangan bahagian B ni, kita pentingkan gramatis. Ayat mesti gramatis. Tak boleh, bukan tak boleh. Nanti mungkin awak akan tertulis ayat tergantung. Tetapi kita memang ambil berat kepada gramatisnya ayat tu. Kalau ayat tu tergantung, memang nampak kat situ kelompong, di situ kelompongan karangan awak. Okay? Tanda baca dan ejaan, pun kena pastikan betul. Pemilihan kosa kata, tema ni ialah idea awak bertepatan dengan tema. Maksudnya idea yang awak berikan bertepatan dengan soalan. Kalau soalan tu mengenai diri sendiri, kan tadi awak pilih, contoh awak pilih soalan nombor satu, mengenai diri sendiri, isi awak mesti bertepatan dengan soalan tu, bertepatan dengan diri awak sendiri. Okay, mesti aku tak nak hurai sangat. Baik. Aspek bahasa yang dinilai, sama juga tata bahasa meliputi ayat dan kata, ejaan, tanda baca, pembahagian perenggan dan pemilihan kata yang tepat. Inilah markahnya. Kriteria penskoran, kalau cemerlang 80 hingga 100, kepujian 66 hingga 79, baik 51 hingga 65 markah, memuaskan 36 hingga 50, kurang memuaskan 21 markah hingga 35 markah dan pencapaian minimum 1 hingga 20. 1 hingga 20 markah ni memang macam cikgu cakap tadi untuk karangan bahagian A sama. Dia memang untuk murid-murid yang tak boleh nak menulis dengan baik. Jadi awak tolong upgrade diri awak untuk dapat cemerlang. Okay? Strategi menulis karangan. Pilih soalan yang tepat. Ini paling penting. Awak memang kena betul-betul pilih soalan yang tepat. Sebab kalau awak tersalah pilih soalan, tiba-tiba dekat tengah jalan awak nak patah balik, awak dah tak boleh patah balik. Maksud cikgu dekat tengah jalan nak patah balik tu, awak dah tulis lah peringkat pengenalan, peringkat isi pertama, isi kedua, tiba-tiba isi ketiga awak stuck. Awak tak ada isi. Awak tak boleh nak tulis dah. Rasa macam, alamak, apa isi lagi? Awak tak tahu. Jadi pilih soalan dengan tepat. Pilih soalan yang awak betul-betul boleh jawab, awak betul-betul ada pengetahuan. Sebab tu cikgu kata pilih soalan satu dengan soalan dua. Kalaulah katalah tiba-tiba tahun tu semua calon pilih soalan dengan satu dengan soalan dua, ganggu tak pemberian markah? Tak ganggu apa-apa. Jangan risau, jangan takut. Yang kedua, menentukan kunci tajuk. Maksudnya bila awak baca, awak tahu tajuk nak apa. Contoh kalau soalan tu nak langkah, awak cerita tentang langkah lah. Janganlah soalan nak langkah, tiba-tiba awak cerita ke stand. Sediakan rangka karangan. Rangka karangan ni penting. Awak kena buat rangka karangan sedikit. Cikgu rasa, cikgu yakin, cikgu subjek awak pun mesti ajar macam mana nak tulis rangka karangan supaya menjadi panduan untuk awak menulis karangan dengan baik. Tulis karangan dan semak karangan. Semak karangan penting sebab nak semak ejaan, semak semula ayat dan juga semak pemerengganan. Baik. Yang ni kata kunci tajuk. Yang ni kata kunci tajuk ni bukan apa, kata kunci tajuk ni ialah soalan yang ditanyakan dalam kertas soalan lah, ditanyakan kepada awak lah untuk awak jawab. Nyatakan sebab, cadangkan cara, nyatakan perasaan, berikan hujah, huraikan peranan, ulaskan, macam tu. Okay. Analisis tajuk, contoh soalan ni, buruh asing banyak yang bekerja di negara kita. Mereka ini hanya banyak bekerja di sektor peladangan, pembinaan dan perkilangan. Kemasukan mereka banyak menimbulkan kesan. Huraikan kesan daripada kemasukan buruh asing ini kepada negara kita. Okey, yang cikgu kuningkan tu, huraikan kesan tu. Maksudnya awak kena beri kesan lah kepada negara. Dia tak kata kepada masyarakat ni, kepada negara. Maksudnya awak baca je soalan ni, awak garis lah elok-elok dan buat kena alert huraikan kesan tu kepada negara kita. Okey, apa yang akan berlaku? Macam tu. Jangan tiba-tiba awak bagi contoh, awak bagi huraian tu, kesan tu kepada diri awak sendiri. Tak boleh, salah. Itu akan jadi impression, markah akan jadi tu kurang. Markah awak nanti tak boleh dapat cemerlang. Okey. Kata kunci, huraikan kesan, skop kesan daripada kemasukan buruh, tema kemasukan buruh asing. Kehendak soalan memberi pendapat. Okey, ini adalah karangan beri pendapat. Jadi karangan terbuka lah kan, jenis karangan pendapat. Okey, menulis pendahuluan. Ni cikgu bagi jenis-jenis pendahuluan. Dekat sini cikgu bagi dua contoh, tiga contoh sahaja. Contoh jenis pendahuluan. Yang ni pendahuluan mengikut definisi. Kenapa cikgu bagi contoh ni kepada awak? Sebab ini adalah contoh-contoh yang murid calon selalu gunakan untuk menulis sebagai pengenalan kepada karangan dia. Okey, definisi memang awak kena nyatakan menurut Kamus Dewan, terus tulis. Cuma cikgu nak tunjukkan dekat sini. Dekat sini cikgu ada letak tanda, cikgu ada letak tanda pembuka kata tu kan. Sebenarnya tak perlu, tak payah tulis, tak payah pembuka kata tu, awak terus je tulis perkataan tu. Tapi kalau awak nak gunakan definisi, tiba-tiba awak tak ingat, awak tak ingat pun apa Kamus Dewan cakap, awak boleh tulis sendiri, dibenarkan. Dan kata-kata hikmat yang awak cipta sendiri pun dibenarkan sebenarnya dalam karangan, dalam karangan bahagian B, sebab dekat situlah nampak kreatifnya awak menulis. Okay, katalah awak terlupa, janganlah tiba-tiba awak pandai-pandai reka sendiri, tak bolehlah. Kalau contoh ayat Quran, ayat Al-Quran dibenarkan, tetapi awak jangan tipu, jangan salah maksud ke, salah ayat ke, tak boleh. Awak mesti gunakan yang betul sahaja. Dan yang kedua, pendapat. Yang ni awak berikan pendapat, okay? Berikan pendapat. Jenis pendahuluan, jenis memberikan pendapat. Yang seterusnya, pendahuluan peribahasa. Okay. Peribahasa sekarang, bila awak tulis karangan, tak perlukan lagi pembuka kata dan penutup kata ni. Awak boleh terus tulis sahaja peribahasa tu, macam yang cikgu merahkan ni, yang kuningkan ni tak perlu. Awak boleh tulis seperti yang cikgu merahkan, seperti kacang lupakan kulit, terus sahaja karangan peribahasa tu, tak payah pembuka dan penutup kata lagi. Okey, ini adalah contoh sahaja. Baik, okey. Berapa isi yang diperlukan untuk mendapat markah yang cemerlang? Berapa perenggan yang diperlukan? Contoh apa yang patut, yang sepatutnya diberikan? Okey. Berapa isi yang sepatutnya diperlukan untuk mendapat markah yang cemerlang? Isi untuk dapat markah yang cemerlang sebenarnya 3 pun dah memadai. Tetapi dengan syarat, isi yang awak huraikan mestilah sekurang-kurangnya 1 muka surat. Sekiranya awak tak yakin untuk hurai sampai dapat 1 muka surat, lebih baik cikgu cadangkan awak beri 4 atau 5 isi atau 6 isi. Okey? Kalau awak tak yakin, awak berilah 4, 5 dan 6 isi. Itu lebih, karangan awak akan lebih nampak menarik. Dan berapa panjang sebenarnya nak tulis satu perenggan? Setengah muka surat. Setengah muka surat kertas peperiksaan tu. Nanti kan awak jawab peperiksaan kan dalam kertas, okey, separuh daripada tu dah sangat memadai untuk awak huraikan. Maksudnya sekurang-kurangnya dalam satu perenggan tu ada 2 atau 3 huraian. Okey, berapa perenggan yang diperlukan? Tadi cikgu kata beri 3 isi kan. Kalau awak beri 3 isi, minimum perenggan adalah 5 lah. Selebihnya awak nak tulis 5 tu sebab 3 isi. Kalau awak nak beri 4, 6, 7, 8, ia dibenarkan. Dia tak ada masalah. Pemerengganan tak ada masalah, asalkan isi awak relevan dan juga tak terpesong. Okay. Contoh apa yang sepatutnya diberikan? Okay, kat sini cikgu nak buat uraian sedikit. Kalau awak menulis pastu karangan, lepas awak nak beri contoh, contoh perasaan kasih sayang. Bila awak nak beri contoh perasaan, awak kena berhati-hati. Contoh perasaan yang diberikan mestilah melibatkan manusia sahaja. Jangan melibatkan haiwan. Sebab bila awak libatkan haiwan, ada satu tahun tu lembaga tak terima jawapan contoh tu. Sebab dia kata haiwan tidak ada perasaan. Yang ada perasaan cuma manusia sahaja. Jadi berhati-hati bila awak beri contoh, berilah contoh yang melibatkan manusia. Okay? Okay, penutup. Ini adalah contoh penutup. Contoh sajalah sebab awak pun cikgu rasa mahir menulis karangan. Sekurang-kurangnya ni jadi panduan sajalah kat mana awak nak tambah baik karangan awak. Okay. Okay, ini adalah contoh ungkapan menarik yang boleh digunakan dalam karangan. Peribahasa. Peribahasa sebenarnya dikategorikan sebagai ungkapan yang menarik yang boleh digunakan dalam karangan. Maksudnya bila awak guna peribahasa dalam karangan, karangan awak akan jadi cantik tau, cantik. Cantik ni maksudnya bila kita baca tu kita rasa macam seronok nak baca karangan dia. Sebab itulah fungsi peribahasa sebenarnya. Sebab orang Melayu zaman dahulu memang cerita peribahasa sebagai keindahan bahasa Melayu. Okey. Yang seterusnya ialah contoh saja, dasar warsa ini, marsya pada ini, mutahir ini, sama maksud dengan dewasa ini, maya pada, manja pada, dunia, arus globalisasi, arus modernisasi, arus pemodenan, dunia tempat sepadan, zaman moden. Ni adalah contoh-contoh ungkapan menarik yang boleh digunakan dalam karangan. Janganlah takut macam cikgu pelik lah perkataan tu. pelik tetapi betul, tak apa, gunakan sahaja. Jangan pelik tapi tak betul, tu tak boleh. Okey. Daripada sinilah awak punya kosakata yang tepat dan luas tu dikenal pasti. Daripada sinilah juga markah awak akan naik daripada kukujang kepada cemerlang. Kita tak tahu. Okey. Cubalah sehabis baik untuk tulis karangan yang terbaik. Sekian, terima kasih daripada cikgu. Itulah sahaja yang cikgu nak kongsikan kepada kamu semua. Harap dapat membantu kamu semua untuk menjawab karangan.
Okey. Okey cikgu, tadi saya ada baca soalan. Dia cakap, saya tak pastilah dia dekat karangan mana, tapi saya rasa untuk kedua-duanya lah. So dia kata, perlu tak catat patah perkataan? Kalau tak catat tu boleh tak?
Okey, macam ni. Kalau untuk karangan bahagian A, yang tu perlu catat. Tapi pada karangan bahagian B, kalau awak tak catat pun tak ada masalah. Yang pentingnya adalah pada karangan bahagian A. Sebab karangan bahagian A tu patah perkataannya dia beri antara kan 200 hingga 250 patah perkataan. Okey.
Okey. So soalan yang kedua.
Ya.
Perlu ke letak peribahasa tu? Sebab cikgu cakap tadi peribahasa tu dia sebagai ungkapan yang menarik. So perlu tak untuk letak dalam setiap perenggan karangan?
Tak perlulah sampai setiap perenggan karangan. Kalau awak sangat mahir dengan peribahasa, gunakanlah, tak ada masalah. Tetapi cukuplah kalau dalam karangan awak tu sekurang-kurangnya ada dua peribahasa.
Okay, lepas tu ada lagi. Dia kata soalan ni dia cakap ada tak cara mudah untuk menulis karangan?
Karangan. Itulah cikgu cakap tadi. Kalau cikgu nak ajar karangan, dia akan jadi bengkel. Sebenarnya cara mudah untuk menulis karangan ni, macam mana nak suruh PM ke? Cara mudah untuk menulis karangan. Sebenarnya banyak sekarang ni.
Kalau saya akan cakap dengan student, kena rajin buat latihan. You akan mahir dalam menulis. So mungkin cikgu macam mana?
Betul. Yang betul. Yang pertama buat latihan. Yang keduanya kena banyak membaca. Jangan banyak main game. Kena banyak membaca.
Sebab betul.
Pembacaan lah. Kosakata awak akan jadi luas. Bila kosakata awak luas, bila awak nak menulis, awak ada idea. Apa yang awak nak tulis, apa yang perlu awak tulis. Sebab awak punya idea tu akan jadi relevan dengan isu semasa. Sebab tu kena banyak sedikit membaca. Tapi kalau awak rasa macam susah lah cikgu, karangan memang susah. Lagi-lagi budak lelaki kan. Sekarang ni ada banyak cikgu nak cakap Google. Sebenarnya banyak kit mengarang dekat internet. Awak boleh cari. Salah satunya adalah kit mengarang Selangor. Yang tu cikgu suggest dalam bahasa Melayu apa? Cadangkan.
Cadangkan. Okay. Rasanya cikgu dah jawab dah. Okay, soalan terakhir saya ambil soalan karangan Komsas.
Okay,
kalau dia pilih karangan Komsas tu, dia tanya perlu ke nak masukkan pantun dalam setiap perenggan? Pantun sajak ke macam tu lah kalau bagian Komsas tu. Saya jarang student ada jawab soalan kalau Komsas ni lah, tapi dia ada tanya.
Kan bermaksud. Ya, jarang. Sebab itulah macam ni, kenapa cikgu, tadi ada cikgu cakap yang, sekejap cikgu cerita sikit tau. Tadi kan ada cikgu cakap yang bila awak bagi contoh yang perasaan tu melibatkan manusia kan. Sebab ada satu tahun tu soalan Komsas yang keluar, dia tanya nilai kasih sayang, huraikan nilai kasih sayang. Tapi bila Komsas ni kita macam kena bercerita tu lebih laras sastra tau. Laras sastra ni bukan bermaksud-maksud pantun pada setiap karangan. Tapi dia macam kita bercerita tu laras-laras sastra. Bercerita tentang sastra lah. Penggunaan perkataan pun lebih kepada laras sastra. Lepas tu ada satu tahun tu, calon ni karangan dia sangat baik. Saya baca karangan dia. Tetapi dia bagi contoh, karangan tu karangan peribahasa kan. Dia bagi contoh tu tupai. Tupai sayangkan anak dia jatuh atas tanah. Kita baca pun emosi kita terganggu tau. Macam dia sangat pandai bercerita. Laras sastra dia sangat cantik. Tetapi karangan dia baik, kami nak bagi cemerlang tak dapat. Sebab dia memberi contoh tu haiwan, bukan manusia. Lembaga tolak sebab dia kata haiwan tak ada perasaan, cikgu. Yang ada perasaan manusia sahaja. Sebab tu lah rasalah cikgu tak cadangkan untuk jawab.
Okay, kita teruskan. Untuk soalan perlu letak peribahasa tadi cikgu dah jawab ya Danish. Cikgu kata boleh nak letak ataupun tak letak. Okay, dia kata soalan bahagian B. Ni soalan daripada Syafiq bahagian B. Kalau nak kesan, minta kesan, boleh buat kesan positif dan negatif ke? Maksudnya dia bagi dua-dua ataupun nak kena bagi satu.
Macam ni, bila kesan positif dan kesan negatif ni tengok kepada soalan. Tengok kepada soalan. Kalau soalan tu berbentuk macam contoh soalan tanya pasal dadah. Awak tak boleh bagi kesan positif sebab dadah mana ada. Mungkin satu je kesan positif. Cikgu, saya isap dadah saya tenang cikgu. Tenang. Tenang betul.
Bergantung pada soalan.
Bergantung kepada soalan sebab yang kalau satu je positif yang lain semua negatif.
Okay.
Jangan. Maksudnya macam tu.
Okay, teruskan. Banyak yang soalan tapi saya pilih-pilih juga. So dia kata daripada Sharifah, dia cakap kalau untuk satu isi tu sekurang-kurangnya lebih kurang berapa kita nak kena buat huraian?
Satu isi sekurang-kurangnya berapa nak buat huraian? Macam cikgu kata tadi, kalau awak yakin dengan isi awak tu, awak nak tulis tiga isi sahaja, huraian karangan awak mesti satu muka surat, macam lebih kurang satu muka surat tau. Jadi huraian awak akan jadi banyak lebih daripada kena ada 3, 4, 5 dan lebih. Tetapi kalau awak rasa macam okey awak nak banyak isi, huraian awak sekurang-kurangnya 3. 3 untuk satu isi.
Faham. Okey, saya teruskan. Okey, untuk soalan berikutnya daripada galeri, mungkin nama dia galeri ni. Cikgu, kalau pendapat toko, kadang-kadang nama pendapat toko lupa. So boleh tak nak reka? Dia nak reka.
Okey, awak nak reka tokoh kan, awak nak reka pendapat. Macam ni. Reka pendapat boleh, reka pendapat boleh, jangan reka tokoh. Sebab tokoh tu wujud. Pendapat dia tu boleh jadi wujud, boleh jadi tak wujud. Mungkin sebenarnya pendapat dia cakap. Tapi awak baca dekat buku tu, cikgu tak baca. So cikgu tak tahu ada ke tak kan. Awak boleh reka pendapat, jangan reka tokoh. Contoh Tun M pernah berkata pada tarikh 15 Julai. Tak kata pun, tapi awak boleh tulis. Macam tu maksudnya.
Okay, berikutnya soalan, mungkin soalan terakhir yang saya ambil daripada Nurul Alia. Dia cakap, cikgu kalau kesalahan bahasa minimum berapa cikgu? Kalau nak kekal dalam cemerlang.
Nak kekal dalam cemerlang. Kesalahan bahasa minimum berapa? Okay, kan cikgu kata tadi kan, sebenarnya macam ni, bila kesalahan bahasa tu awak nak kekal dalam cemerlang, pastikan awak punya karangan tu kurang tanda merah. Sebab bila kertas satu ni penandaan adalah secara holistik, kita akan tengok impression tau. Kalau nampak merah tu kita rasa macam banyak kesalahan. Jadi awak memang kena minimum, paling minimum kena ada 5 sahaja. Paling minimum. Tu pun memang 5 tu pun memang macam dia dah ganggu sedikit tapi masih boleh cemerlang.
Okay. Jadi sebelum berakhir, ada tak apa-apa kata semangat cikgu nak kongsikan untuk yang tengok ni? Kita ada lebih kurang 20,000 pelajar yang dah subscribe di Mahir Tutor. Ya?
Cikgu kagum dengan batch 2020, batch 03 ni sebenarnya. Sebab batch ni sangat diuji. Berapa kali SPM ditunda, kamu kena yakin yang kamu semuanya sangat hebat. Kalau kamu tak hebat, Tuhan takkan uji sebegini. Jadi teruskan usaha, yakin dengan diri sendiri, buatlah yang terbaik. Masa masih ada, walaupun tinggal 29 hari. 29 hari tu masih cukup untuk awak fokus kepada pelajaran. Buatlah yang sehabis baik dan banggakan mak ayah. Buat yang terbaik untuk diri sendiri. Semoga berjaya semua. Cikgu doakan yang mendengar pada hari ini akan dapat keputusan cemerlang untuk bahasa Melayu.
Amin, insyaAllah. Okay, itu saja cikgu pesanan untuk ni. Baik, okay. Terima kasih. Sekali lagi saya ucapkan kepada Cikgu Siti Noraina binti Ahmad di atas meluangkan, kerana meluangkan masa hari ni kan, hari Minggu, faham? Okay, meluangkan masa dengan teknik, tip dan trik dan juga semua benda yang membantulah, semua bahan yang membantu untuk calon SPM kita yang nak ambil SPM tak lama lagi ni. Dan insyaAllah kita akan berhenti berehat. Okay, kita akan berhenti berehat dan kita akan bersambung dalam Bahasa Melayu Kertas 2 pada jam 2 petang nanti bersama dengan cikgu Siti Raina juga. Jangan pergi mana-mana, simpan soalan untuk kertas 2. Okay, so cikgu kita akan berehat. Dan untuk pengetahuan semua yang join, untuk petang ini kita akan berikan link yang berbeza. Jadi untuk memastikan kamu dapat join untuk seminar, pastikan subscribe dekat YouTube Planet Mahir, okay? Alright, sekian saja daripada saya, Cikgu Ayu, dan terima kasih kepada Cikgu Norana. Assalamualaikum. Bye-bye.
Assalamualaikum. Terima kasih.
Sama.
Jadi ayam yang lebih. Jadi
apa pulang lagi ya? Okey, soalan nombor 2 yang popular.
-3 -3 0 2. So kita dapat apa? Negatif. -3 0 2.
Jadi akan
jadi jadi sama-sama kita tumpukan perhatian kepada teori kinetik ciri. Okey.
Dan
tak
percaya
dia tidak guna ajaran yang seperti ini. Kami kena ingat dia diberi gelaran penyelamat umat Islam. Ingat yang itu.
Berkaitan dengan perumpamaan tiang panjang Maharaja Leda.
Dia ni dia berdiri kat tengah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh everyone, and welcome to Mahir Teachers.